this is DeBristol International Raceway for the Mud 500 is like no other night. It's rock and roll racing at the world's fastest half-mile racetrack. The world's leader in motorsports coverage welcomes you live to Bristol International Raceway in Tennessee for the NASCAR Winston Cup Mud 500. It is a hot and humid night here in the hills of Northeast Tennessee. The temperature at this hour is 85 degrees, but the good news is there's only a 20% chance of rain. And welcome everybody to Bristol. I'm Bob Jenkins, and get set for a night of rock and roll racing here at Bristol. You know what kind of a racetrack this is? Banks at 36 degrees. It is always exciting. This is the 21st race of the series, and let's take a look at the point standings. Dale Earnhardt still has the lead by 259 over Dale Jarrett, but second, third, fourth, and fifth are separated by only 118 points. Now, the mere mention of Bristol International Raceway brings excitement to the fans, and it probably brings a few headaches to the race drivers. Who should know that better than a guy who won here on this track a few years ago, Benny Parsons?
Folks, you want to see some excitement, some real excitement? Stay tuned. I'll guarantee you, I'd almost give you a money-back guarantee, you are going to see some excitement. Last night in the Busch Grand National Race, 250 laps, 14 caution flags. Tonight, we're trying to run 500 laps. And one thing wrong for some fast cars back to the field, they've got a couple of good cars up front, Mark Martin and Rusty Wallace. Martin won the last two races, he's on a roll, and Rusty Wallace, Ned, has won three of the last short track races we've been to.
Well, they're going to be tough here tonight, no doubt about it. And they're running so fast, we got a lot of big guns that are starting in the last half of the field, and some of those that are high in the point standings and trying to stay that way here tonight, and it might be tough. This is a tough racetrack to pass on. In fact, you just about got to bump somebody out of the way to get around them, and those guys have got to be aggressive if they're going to even stay in the lead lap. But do you be aggressive and take a chance of getting into the wall, or do you display a little bit of patience? Well, that's something they'll have to decide, and I'll tell you, it's going to be a long night for some of those guys because they are at another disadvantage as well. Right, Jerry Punch?
Exactly, Ned. You know, every driver knows the high banks here at Bristol can unravel your chance for a championship in a split second. The bad news for Dale Earnhardt, well, he qualified in 19th spot. By virtue of 0.004 of a second, he will pit over on the back straightaway. The good news for Dale Earnhardt, his closest pursuer, Dale Jarrett, well, will start inside of row 17, 33rd starting spot. And when they take the green flag, Dale Jarrett will be almost a half a lap behind. But he's in some pretty good company back here because beside him over here is Ernie Irvin, who had to go to a backup car, crash the primary car and qualify. Some heavy hitters starting toward the back of the field in front of Ernie Irvin. Jimmy Spencer in front of him. Sterling Marlin. Bobby Hillen is back here. Why are heavy hitters in the back of the field? There's a reason for that. Let's go to John Kernan.
Jerry, the young Lions are really coming on strong here at Bristol. Of the top 15 qualifiers, seven of those drivers have never won a race, including Bobby Labonte, one of the rookie drivers who's coming on in the second half of the season. You can see the improvement in his performance in the last 10 races. The first 10 races, he did not have a top 10 finish. He has four top 10 finishes in the last 10 races. Crew Chief Tim Brewer says that the team is starting to mature and to gel. And a lot of people say that Bobby Labonte and Bill Davis Racing should win a race before the year is out.
Well, Bobby Labonte has the best starting position among the rookies, but we will be riding with Jeff Gordon, who has qualified for eighth position in the Bud 500, which is moments away here on ESPN. Our Speed World coverage is brought to you by the Heartbeat of America, Chevrolet, and your local Chevy dealer. By the new advanced high-tech formula Quaker State Motor Oil. It's formulated for today's high-tech engines. And by Allied Signals Autolite Spark Plugs, guaranteed for 2 years no matter how far you go. Joe Blimp is on hand here at Bristol providing the aerial shots, and look at the incredible crowd that is gathered here. They put more seats up here since the spring, and every one of them is filled. It's a record crowd. Here's the starting lineup for tonight's race. The hottest driver on the circuit, Mark Martin, has the pole, qualifying the Valvoline Ford at 121.4. That's car number six. He'll be joined by the guy who dominated the short track racing in the early part of the season, Rusty Wallace, in the Miller Genuine Draft Pontiac. The second row has Ricky Rudd in the Tide Chevrolet, car number five, and Bobby Labonte in the Maxwell House Coffee Ford, car number 22. The third row, Hut Strickland in the McDonald's Ford, car number 27, then number 44, the STP Pontiac, driven by Rick Wilson. The fourth row, Derek Cope in the Bojangles Ford, car number 98, and the DuPont Chevrolet, car number 24, driven by Jeff Gordon. The fifth row, it's Jimmy Hensley in the number 7 Family Channel Ford, and alongside will be the Skull Bandit Chevrolet, car 33, driven by Harry Gant. Jeff Bodine's Motorcraft Ford, car number 15, has the 11th starting position, flanked by the Skull Classic Ford, but driven by Rick Mast, car number 1. The seventh row, it is Brett Bodine and Bill Elliott. In the eighth row, Bobby Hamilton and Morgan Shepherd, going to row number 9. The defending champion, Darrell Waltrip and Terry Labonte, Dale Earnhardt and Kyle Petty in row number 10. The 11th row, Lake Speed and Wally Dallenbach, Kenny Wallace and Michael Waltrip in the 12th row. And as you look at the rest of the starting lineup, you can see the cars move down the front straightaway. And in just a couple of more laps, we'll have the green flag and 500 laps of competition. Well, we've talked about how unique this track is, and indeed it's the world's fastest half-mile track, Bristol International Raceway in the northeastern hills of Tennessee. The pole speed was 121.4, time 15.805 seconds. We'll go 500 laps, and the field is separated by a little more than half a second. Well, there's a look at Bristol International Raceway. The turns here are banked at 36 degrees down in turns 1 and 2. You come off that onto the backstretch, and it appears to be relatively flat, but in fact, the backstretch and the front stretch are both banked at 16 degrees. It is 650 feet in length. Down in turns 3 and 4, again, you'll find banking that is the highest of any NASCAR Winston Cup track, 36 degrees. And onto the front straightaway, again, a 16-degree bank. And there are pits here on both the front stretch and the back stretch.
And all those cars in row 10 back will be pitting on the back stretch. Only 18 spots on the front, the other 16 spots on the back. In car camera with Jeff Bodine's Motorcraft Ford, also the Ford telemetry. We can see he's in second gear at 4,300 RPMs.
Morgan Shepherd also has an in-car camera in his Citgo Ford, and the leading rookie contender, although he is not the fastest rookie in this race, is Jeff Gordon, and we will have a in-car camera in his car also. Well, it appears as if they're going to go one more time. Everybody has risen as if to watch the start of this race, but instead they will go around one more time before we get the green flag.
We all jumped up to watch the green flag, and guess what? They tricked us. There we see Jeff Bodine in second gear. These cars will start in second. He'll shift to third, back to fourth, and that's where he'll keep the car. Oh, we got a piece of debris on the racetrack already.
That's the reason why we didn't go green. There was a piece of debris on the racetrack, so that has been retrieved by one of the NASCAR officials. And now the lights atop the pace car are no longer flashing. Dick Trickle, by the way, is standing by for relief for Kenny Wallace, who broke his shoulder blade in a crash at the Indianapolis Motor Speedway during their test a few days ago. And so Dick Trickle will be relieving Kenny as soon as possible.
And, of course, they would hope to do that during a caution flag. And you know how cautions are here, Crystal. We see a lot of them. That could come early.
It'll probably come early. The crowd is on its feet, 72,000 strong. We're glad you could be with us. The Bud 500 is on.
What a magnificent start.
notice how the cars at this point are strung out, and indeed, as we said earlier in the show, they are already separated by a half a lap, and we are just four laps into this race.
Everyone pretty well in single file. This is basically a one-groove racetrack, and that one groove is on the low side of the racetrack.
We can see where Nitti's talking, right on the next to the black asphalt. Here's Mark Martin, the leader, and Rusty Wallace had fallen back to third. He takes over from Ricky Rudd.
Bobby Labonte is running in fourth, and Hutch Strickland, Derek Cope, and Rick Wilson follow them, but now the best battle is for second position. Back now to fourth spot. There's Labonte and Strickland. And Cope sneaking up there to make it a three-car race.
And Rick Wilson. A lot of these cars, the best run they've had this year. And, look out. Oh, man, that was close.
Well, that's what all it takes is one little tap going into the turn. And you can be spun around. But Bobby Labonte drove high there, but he's losing lots of positions.
Did not spin, but he's losing lots of positions here as Jeff Bodine goes to the inside. Here comes Brett Bodine. Jimmy Hensley will be next to attempt to pass Bobby Labonte.
Man, Ernie Irvin is gone down the back straightaway. He hits the wall just a little bit. I don't think there's a lot of damage, and so far NASCAR has not thrown the caution flag.
It's well off the racetrack. It's on the apron.
Now,
it's out. Yeah. So we have our first caution on the 10th lap. Here they come down to take the caution. Dale Earnhardt started 19th. And I believe he's moved up a couple of positions, maybe 17th at the moment. But our caution is because of Ernie Irvin's spin on the backstretch.
Well, Irvin's on the inside of Jimmy Spencer. Moved on the inside of him there, and there's Phil Parsons in the car 41, and Irvin just out there by himself. The back end brakes look similar to the way when he qualified this afternoon. That put him back there, had to take a provisional spot to get in the field. The car just broke loose right in that same spot, almost that same spot.
And this is a backup car. Ned said he didn't make the field with his qualifying. His first lap wasn't fast enough to make the field. On his second qualifying lap, he spun, crashed the car, and had to go to this car at backup.
And here's Jerry Punch with a report.
And just to add to what Benny Parsons was saying, this is a backup car. This is not a short track race car. Actually, this is the car that Ernie Irvin used to finish second in Atlanta back in early March this year. It's actually an intermediate car. They worked for the past hour and a half here in this heat at Bristol, Tennessee, trying to get the car dialed in. They couldn't quite get a handle on the car, and Ernie's sort of struggling here early on. Let's check into the back pits now with John Kernan.
Jerry, what a break for the Dirt Devil Pontiac team as Kenny Wallace broke the tip of his right shoulder blade in an accident at Indianapolis testing. He was going to run until the first caution. They had hoped that it would come early. It has. Dick Trickle standing by to get into the car. In fact, Kenny ran six laps today as he gets out with no problem. Dick Trickle sliding in. It will need to be a very quick change. He ran six laps today and told me that it did not hurt, that he thought he could probably go longer, but he wanted to be in just so he would not injure it further. Now let's go to Dr. Jerry Punch.
I spoke with Kenny Wallace. You know, what he broke was the very bottom part of the scapula. He said the shoulder blade on the right side up in Indianapolis. It isn't a serious injury, but it can be very painful. And with the vibration and the G-force here at Bristol, Tennessee, his car owner, Felix Sabatos, didn't want to take a chance on having him injured. He felt that possibly if he was stood out here tonight, he'd be able to go full bore next week at Darlington in the Southern 500s. He's going to get out here early and put the veteran Dick Trickle in the car.
Meanwhile, the green flag is coming out, and Trickle did not lose a lap. He and the others managed to stay on the lead lap, and there were a couple of other cars that pitted, including Wally Dallenbach Jr. and Bobby Hillen. Green out once again. Mark Martin leads Rusty Wallace, Ricky Rudd, and Hutch Strickland. John Kernan is with Kenny Wallace.
Well, Kenny, you guys wanted an early caution. You got it. A very quick driver's change without losing a lap. Didn't look like you were hurting too bad when you climbed out.
No, the Dirt Devil car's running really good. You know, I hated to see Ernie spin in front of me. I had to barely miss that, but Dick Trickle's done a good job all week long for us, and I think he'll do good today.
Dick Trickle is in the car. Of course, Dick Trickle, a short track specialist, has run well in the past here at Bristol. They're hoping for him to do a really good job tonight.
Trickle trying to move up through the traffic.
And Rick Wilson's spun over in turn two. the STP Pontiac. Looks like some, oh, and Lake Speed spins around. I think Lake got bumped from behind. I don't think there's a lot of damage to Lake's car, but he needs to get it going the other direction or he's going to get lapped. Go down pit road now, Lake.
I don't think he's, well, yeah, he is, because Mark has slowed the field down so that Lake is going to stay on the lead lap. But Rick Wilson's car is disabled on the apron off of corner number two. And here's another look at it.
This is Jeff Gordon, the 24 car. The DuPont Automotive finishes car right behind Rick Wilson. And looks like a little bit of bump from Gordon. And you see Gordon got,
yeah, Jeff, he got bumped by Bodine.
Bumped right. The back of him.
Typical Bristol racing. And watch how Lake Speed became involved.
Well, he dives down on the inside a little bit too hard there. And really, his left wheels look like we're down on the flat part of the pavement.
Yeah.
Just spun him around.
Looks like Lake and his spotter haven't worked that much together. And the other cars were slowing down. Lake's car was not slowing down.
Already two cautions in the first 18 laps of this race. Couple of spins already by Ernie Irvin and Rick Wilson. We'll be back with more live coverage in a moment. Back at Bristol International Raceway, the shot is from the Blockbuster video blimp hovering high above this half-mile racetrack. Here's Jerry Punch with an update on Rick Wilson.
The first victim of the Bristol High Banks tonight, the STP Pontiac, has been on pit road just a minute ago and is now back in. The obvious cosmetic sheet metal damage, one concern, but the biggest concern, something you can't see very easily at home. That is a toe-out situation. The front tire's actually pointing in the opposite direction. He got tagged from behind. The right front tire pointing to the right side, the left front pointing to the left side, and Robbie Lubas, now the crew chief, under the car, trying to get that adjustment made. As the cars come by, he loses another lap here in the pits. Once again, a replay. Here's what happened to the Bartow, Florida driver, Rick Wilson. In turn two, the car loops around, spins. He gets contact. There's some sheet metal damage. A tough break after a great qualifying effort. Also, the car number 28 spinning to avoid the car number 44. Let's check in on his progress with John Kernan.
Jerry, Lake Speed has been in twice through the pits. All they've had to do is pull away some sheet metal and also change all four tires. Larry McReynolds and the crew say there is nothing wrong with the car except sheet metal damage, so they think they should be all right.
Looks like Lake just went for a hole. It closed up, and he had to get on the brakes and spin the car.
Yep. Didn't hit anything. Just spun her around.
All right. Pace car ducks off the track once again. We're ready for a restart. Again, the top five are Martin, Wallace, Rudd, Strickland, and Cope. Green out.
Rusty Wallace gave Martin a little boost just to start finish line, because under NASCAR rules, Rusty Wallace legally could not pass him until he got to the start finish line. So he wisely stayed back there, but gave him a little boost.
Rick Wilson taking his car behind the wall as we watch the car going to turn one.
Looking to the inside of Martin, unable to pass. Passing, as we've indicated, very difficult on this racetrack that is basically one groove. Normally, as we go ahead in the race, the groove moves up a little bit, allowing side-by-side passing, but not at this point.
There we see Hunt Strickland, the fourth car in line, the McDonald's Ford. A good call for it. Let's give a call for him, because one of his better runs this year.
Yeah, remember, he ran strong at those at Martinsville in the early year and led a lot of laps up there.
And Dale Earnhardt is passing cars right and left. You saw him pass Bobby Labonte. And I believe he's up to 13th position already. Earnhardt is 13th, started 19th.
And Kyle Petty started 20th. He's up to 12th. He is right in front of Dale Earnhardt. That will be the next car that Earnhardt has to catch. There we see Kyle Petty following along behind Harry Gantt.
And Jeff Gordon passes Derek Cope. A nice move by Jeff in turn number four. And now Cope is hung on the outside.
Yep, he's hung on the outside, and the train is going to go by. He's trying to get to the bottom.
Brett Bodine is there, however, to bump him out of the way.
Bodine went down, caught the apron with his left front tire, almost spun up in two.
And now Cope does get to the inside.
Jim Hensley right there and all of that banging around. A little bit of an emotional favorite here as they came back to Bristol. That would be Alan Kowicki on team, as Brett Bodine now makes the pass.
And so does Hensley
in the family channel Ford. Now Cope trying to get to the inside,
but Morgan Shepherd this time will block his entrance to the low line.
Meanwhile, Kyle Petty, I said he was in front of Dale Earnhardt. That's no longer the situation because we can see that Earnhardt has gotten by in contact between Harry Ganico.
Hope just getting booted out of the way, it appears. Oh, and a big crash down in turn one. Several cars involved. Bobby Hamilton, Darrell Waltrip, Jimmy Spencer, Terry Labonte is badly damaged. So is Sterling Marlin.
Wow.
There's the damage on Ken Schrader's Kodiak Chevrolet. And Darrell Waltrip, the defending champion of this race, and his fans were hoping that he could turn his season around as he got back to the short tracks. Now, we mentioned earlier how this can take points away from you and even a championship, and boy, we have seen the action already as three cars are badly damaged at the bottom of turn two.
And it looked like that the 22 car of Bobby Labonte, no, that's not
Marlin.
That's the Bobby car. Hamilton car.
Yeah, the 20 car.
Dick Moroso's car, the Phenaloop car, went in the corner and just car went around all of a sudden.
He could have been touched by Sterling Marlin, who was right behind him. But Dale Jarrett, and look how Spencer got up on two wheels. Now watch the cars that come through here escaping damage.
There's Phil Parsons and Dale Jarrett way down on the inside. They both get through without, they might have touched a couple of cars, but there you see Jarrett going on by the 25 car of Ken Schrader.
Marlin, Labonte, and Spencer badly damaged. And there's the number 20 car also of Bobby Hamilton at the bottom of your screen. Now Schrader has been able to drive back to the pit area. He is behind the wall, and they've gone to work trying to get the sheet metal pounded out so he can get back into the race. ESPN Speed World tonight at Bristol International Raceway in Tennessee for the NASCAR Winston Cup Bud 500. There's the badly damaged car of Jimmy Spencer. Jerry Punch is with him.
And Jimmy has climbed out. They're still working on the accident behind us. Jimmy, first of all, are you okay?
Yeah, I'm fine, Jerry. You know, when stuff happens at Bristol, it happens quick, you know. And two cars got together up there in front of Sterling, me, and a whole bunch of the other guys. And, you know, I got into Terry. There's just nothing that anybody could really do. I guess just a racing accident.
No way to avoid it. We saw Sterling come by. He seems to be okay. Any idea about the other drivers? Everyone seemed to be able to climb out.
Yeah, there's nobody got hurt in that accident, you know, not that I know of. But, you know, it's one of them deals that the guys aren't as fast as the other guys, and it's a real tight racetrack, and I love this place, but it ain't been kind to me. I got to wait until next year.
Jimmy Spencer obviously disappointed. Let's check in with John Curtin, who's standing by with Ken Schrader. John?
Jerry, Kenny is sitting inside his car as the crew works. Kenny, I guess it's just one of those things that can happen at Bristol. If it happens in front of you, you don't have much choice.
I don't know what happened for sure. They all started crashing, and I thought we hit some fluid or something. This thing wouldn't even start to turn, you know, and couldn't slow down real good either. They just said Darrell said somebody dropped something too. But don't make any difference. We're tore up.
They are going to continue to work on the car. It looks like they're going to have to replace the radiator. They're going to have a lot of work to do as the front end. The nose has been pushed all the way back. They had to replace the fan belts and a lot of work, especially on that right front A-frame.
A lot of damage on at least the front end of that Chevrolet Lumina. We mentioned sheet metal and how they're trying to pound it out, but indeed a different kind of composition for many parts of the car. Here is a track fact. Track facts are brought to you by Quaker State. The big Q is one tough motor oil.
The majority of a Winston Cup race car is still sheet metal. But in recent years, many teams have gone to the preformed noses and rear ends that were first fiberglass and now Kevlar. Now, Jeffrey Baker joins us from TriStar Motorsports. Jeff, on race day, we look in your pits and behind the wall, we'll see an entire Kevlar nose piece or rear end. What's the advantage of having Kevlar?
Well, Jerry, in the unforeseen circumstance where you have an accident out on the racetrack, these Kevlar noses hold up better than the materials that we've been able to use in the past. Time is of essence in the pits in order to get that car back out on the racetrack to do the best possible job we can as a team. And if we've got a nose that'll hold up, we can work on the other areas and get the car back out on the racetrack.
So not only the resilience of a Kevlar nose, but also a safety factor. In the old days with sheet metal and sharp bumpers, with a little fender bender in the race, you had sharp debris, metal on the track. No longer the case here in the 90s with Kevlar fiber.
What we had here was a little more than a fender bender. Six cars were involved in that crash, including Darrell Waltrip, Jimmy Spencer, Ken Schrader, and others. And now a lot of work is to be done by some of the crews to get their drivers back out there in competition. We're live at Bristol International Raceway in Tennessee, and we'll be right back. It is under caution here at Bristol International Raceway. Jerry Punch is with another one of the drivers involved in the incident.
Columbia, Tennessee, Sterling Marlin currently 12th in the points. And Sterling, you climbed out of the car. They're trying to fix it. First of all, what happened up there?
I run the back of Bob Hampton. I don't know if, he saw something that I didn't. If somebody got together in front of him and looked like he checked up, or somebody checked up in front of him early and I saw it, but I must have caught him by 6 inches over here on the right rear. I tried to miss him and barely hung in the right rear and turned him around. And you hated to have my car was running awful good and just hated to tore everybody's cars up. Just a typical Bristol deal.
Typical Bristol deal. That sums it up. Sterling's going to try to get back in. Let's check in with John Kernan, who's standing by with Darrell Waltrip.
Well, Jerry, you can see the front of Darrell's car. It's been shortened considerably. The team's got a lot of work to do right now. And Darrell, I guess this racetrack, things happen in front of you. There's not a whole lot you can do, is there?
No. Somebody was losing some fluid, and I just called Barry and said, I got to get here somewhere. There's somebody losing fluid in front of me, and I'm going to back up and get out of danger. And I didn't get back fast enough. I saw something going on, but there wasn't anything I could do about it. Bad for the Western Auto team. The car was great. It would have been an easy win for us, but wasn't meant to be. So just praise the Lord that I'm all right, and I'll have at it again next week.
Yeah, but what about the explaining you're going to have to do to your car owner? I mean, you know, it looks torn up pretty bad. Your car owner's going to be pretty mad.
I'll put me a wire goofing here. I've heard them all this year.
Enough said, guys.
All you have to do is just give him a line, and Darrell goes with it, doesn't he? This is a big racing weekend here on ESPN. Wake up tomorrow, have breakfast at Spa-Francorchamps in Belgium, the Grand Prix of Belgium, live at 7:50 tomorrow morning. And then in the afternoon at 4 o'clock Eastern time, catch the Indy cars at the Grand Prix of Vancouver in Canada. So join us for two races tomorrow here on ESPN. Top 10, Mark Martin, Rusty Wallace, Ricky Rudd, Hut Strickland, and Jeff Gordon. 6 through 10, Jeff Bodine, Brett Bodine, Jimmy Hensley, Morgan Shepherd, and Harry Gaynor. At Bristol, the Bud 500, two laps have been completed under green. It's still Mark Martin being chased by Rusty Wallace. There's a little bit of racetrack back to the third place. Ricky Rudd, fourth is Strickland, and fifth is Jeff Gordon.
Tell you what, Rusty is really racing tonight. His car is very, very good. Well, Martin's is as well. So if these two guys run like this for 500 miles, we are going to be treated to a great stock car race.
If they run 500 miles, Benny, we're going to be here even longer than I had hoped for. We're going to run 500 laps tonight.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm in late.
Leading, Rusty Wallace dominated the short track activity in the first half of the season, winning three of the races and finishing second in the other.
Rusty really comes off this corner.
Well, his car is hooked up. That's what helped him to win all those short track races. He wants to get in front so he can lead a lap, and there he goes.
He got it.
He'll get 5 bonus points when he comes back to the start finish line.
Rusty is third in the points, so points are very valuable, and John Kernan is with Bobby Hamilton.
A little bit like John, but it's actually me, Bob. But 1991, Bobby Hamilton. And Bobby, you were the cue ball out there in that 7-car pileup. What happened?
I don't know, Jerry. It looked like we come out 4, and I seen the 98 have some kind of problem, and all of us moved to the bottom of the racetrack before we wouldn't get hung in behind it. Went in down here at 1. Running that low, you know, you just can't get in the corner that hard. It just got backed up. Just a racing accident. I hate it for Dick Moroso and the Finaloo people. Bob Rinaldi had a heck of a motor in the car. The main thing I hate is for some of these guys race for points, because we're just in here trying to get some good runs, get spot shift next year. But you got anything for a headache? I got a terrible headache.
Well, next year this race is sponsored by Goody, so you'll be able to sample the product early. You have a big headache for Bobby Hamilton and 6 other drivers as lightning strikes early here in Thunder Valley.
Thank you, Jerry. That wreck was very costly to Tennessee drivers. 3 of them, Darrell Waltrip, Sterling Marlin, and Bobby Hamilton, were wiped out in that crash. Now up front is Rusty Wallace, followed by Mark Martin. It still remains Rudd, Strickland, and Gordon.
fourth and fifth.
I tell you what, I think that was pretty heady driving by Mark Martin a little bit ago. Rusty Wallace came up. It was obvious he wanted to lead that race, this race, so badly. Mark Martin just basically said, okay, go ahead.
Yeah, he didn't fight him too much.
He didn't fight him too much because when you get up that close and just inches away, just the least little bobbling, both those cars could be around crash. So Mark said, hey, go ahead. We got plenty of time for me to get back in front of you. If I can. And if I can, it doesn't matter anyway.
There is the short track performance by Rusty Wallace. Three wins, the second in four races, has led 905 of the 1,800 laps raced and has four wins here at this facility. Now, Mark Martin has won the last two races, going for three in a row here tonight. And in his last seven performances, he has six top six finishes and has moved from 12th to 4th in the NASCAR Winston Cup points standings.
He has been on a roll.
And it appears as if it will continue tonight. Now the leaders begin to sneak up on some of the slower traffic, and we are going to have lapping here before long. Let's see how much interval there is between second and third. There is Rudd, fourth and fifth. Marlin and Gordon were looking for Dale Earnhardt, and there he is.
Right now, Earnhardt is in 11th spot. You see Kyle Petty back in 12th.
Both of these drivers started in the middle of the pack. Dale started 19th and Kyle started 20th. But you can see that there's almost a half lap separating them and Rusty Wallace, who's leading.
Ooh, Dave Marcus and Jimmy Means got together coming off turn four right in front of the leaders. Here's a great battle.
This is for fourth.
Yes.
Sterling Marlin and whether a Hutch Ricklin is riding with there for a moment, Jeff Gordon.
Gordon is all over the back bumper of Strickland. See how those cars move around. Gordon's car seems to be a little bit more stable than the car of Hutch Strickland.
I don't know if we had a camera looking back at Jeff Gordon, he might be dancing just the way Hutch Strickland's car is, but Strickland's car really dances in the corner. Watch him as he goes in, hits those bumps in the back end, starts bouncing around and he's back and forth. And we see Jeff Gordon had the car a little bit looser to keep up the corner.
Just looking for a little bit of an opening to stick the nose of that Chevrolet up under that Ford.
Ford directly in front of him, so maybe Hutch Strickland will have to back off a little bit for Means, and that will be the opening that Jeff Gordon needs.
Talk about Jimmy Means. He was the last car to qualify this afternoon, and he bumped Ted Musgrave out of the field. Jimmy has had some problems qualifying this year, but made a good run here today and got in.
Well, there was a 1.6-second interval between these two guys and Ricky Rudd, who runs third. Jimmy Means moves to the inside and allows both to pass, and there is Ricky Rudd as he moves through some of the slower traffic.
And he appears to be moving up on the,
yes,
the leaders.
Yeah, he has caught Mark Martin, or has moved within, yeah, just a few car lengths.
Yeah, if Rusty Wallace has moved away from Mark Martin, but now Ricky Rudd is catching the second place car.
This is still the best battle for position on the racetrack as Gordon continues to try to find a way around Hutch Strickland.
Tries. He looks underneath, but Strickland comes down. Oh, one more time. Almost got inside,
yeah,
of him.
I thought maybe he had him there, but he didn't.
And meanwhile, right behind those guys, Kyle Petty. You see him? He has passed Dale Earnhardt, Morgan Shepherd, and Harry Gant. So he has a mellow yellow Pontiac on the move.
Kyle had a good short track season in the early part of 1993. And John Curtin has more on that. John?
You know, Bob, this afternoon I was talking with John Wilson, who builds the engines for Kyle Petty's car. He told me that only real men pit on the backstretch. And even real men win races from the backstretch. They think that they can do it. They feel that they've got the right setup in the race car, that if cautions fall in the right frame of time for them near the end of the race, that they feel they can win this race from the backstretch.
Well, it's difficult to win from the backstretch, but it's not impossible.
Davey Allison did it a couple of years ago. He won from sitting on the backstretch.
Look at this. Gordon, this is all over Hunt. On to the good battles going on here at Bristol International Raceway. We're glad you could join us for the Bud 500. We completed 73 out of 500 laps. Well, tonight's appearance by the Blockbuster Video Blimp is part of the 93 maiden tour through the eastern half of the United States. Piloting the ship tonight is Mats Backlund from Sweden, a long way home. And Mark Martin has just taken the lead from Rusty.
Well, he just drove up there and drove around him. Rusty had pulled away a little bit in traffic a while back, but Martin caught him in a hurry and just moved right on around.
And Ricky Rudd has moved up now on the back bumper of Rusty.
And some heavy, heavy traffic right in front of Mark Martin. Some really good race cars. We'll see Bobby Hillen, Michael Walker, Darrell Jarrett, Bill Elliott.
Here's a look again at how Mark is able to get the lead away from Rusty.
This is not a replay. This is live.
This is the real thing.
As it's happening. That's Bobby Hill in the Halleck Myers car right direct in front of Mark Martin.
And here's Prumble coming off of turn four. Hutch Strickland is into the wall hard.
He tore the back end completely off of that race car.
Well, I tell you what, that is a break, a big, big break for those cars right in front of their leaders. There we see Phil Parson, Michael Dale Jarrett, all beating our leader, Mark Martin, back to the line. I would think we'd see some pit stops this time.
Yep.
Hutch Strickland really had bad contact with the fourth turn wall. It looks like he's going to drive the car away, but
minus the back end.
I mean, for all practical purposes, the back end of that
thing
is gone.
He doesn't know how badly that car is torn up. Where is that fuel tank?
Wow, it's gone.
Well, we're watching that battle between he and Jeff Gordon. And let's see, as they come off the turn, Hunt goes a little bit high. Gordon gets up under him, nudges him just a little bit. That's all it took. And then Jeff Bodine rams into the rear of Jeff Gordon. Kyle Petty dips down to the inside, goes on by. But look at the damage to the McDonald's Ford.
And pit stops galore.
You are right about the pit stops. Look at him coming in. Let's go to Jerry Punchers with Rusty Wallace.
Watching the Miller Genuine Draft crew perform their... What a ballet here. Right side tires already on. They go to the left side of the car, cleaning the windshield. And Rusty Wallace and Miller Genuine Draft Pontiac. It is a race on pit road as Mark is leaving pits. Wallace leaving the pits. We're watching Mark Martin's Valvoline 40 service. And now Martin's out. And here is the car number five headed back to turn one. Let's go to John Kernan. Jerry Kyle Petty is pulled in. He's at the first pit at the exit of pit road here on the backstretch. Rusty Wallace streaks by. So does Mark Martin. Left side tire is going on. There will be no chassis adjustment. We see Lake Speed and Dale Earnhardt heading down pit road as it will be Kyle Petty, Lake Speed, Dale Earnhardt. Earnhardt took on four tires and they loosened the car up a little bit.
So everybody getting back out onto the racetrack and in a proper formation for a restart here. Doesn't appear to be a whole lot of debris down there in the fourth turn.
Let's look at this in-car camera from Jeff Gordon's car and listen to it as they go down turn three.
And Gordon was lucky that he wasn't involved in that. He could have T-boned Hunt real easily.
Yeah, he got hit a little bit from the rear by Jeff Bodine. I don't think it did any damage. Perhaps not much damage to the car.
Mark Martin went in the lead. He came out second. Rusty Wallace, who was running second, came out first. Ricky Rudd third is fourth. Jeff Gordon went in fourth. He's now sixth. And Kyle Petty went in fifth. He came out eighth. That's really the victim of pitting on the backstretch.
Yeah, but that's still not bad.
Not bad at all.
And for the fans that might have watched it over the years and how much of a disadvantage it was pitting on the backstretch, starting at Martinsville back in
April,
they started speeding up after they dropped the front pit cars off, and they speeded up so that those could get to the back stretch a little bit quicker, so that has helped those back. They're not quite as much of a disadvantage as it used to be.
There's a nice aerial shot of this racetrack and the 1,072,000 people that have gathered here for this race here tonight. We're under caution, and we'll be back with more after these messages. 89 laps have been completed. Let's take a look at the top 20. It's Wallace, Martin, Bodine, Rudd, and Bodine. Brett in the top five. Then Jeff Gordon, Harry Gant, Kyle Petty. Lake Speed has moved to ninth, and Dale Earnhardt has moved to the top 10. 11 through 15, Hensley, Shepard, Dick Trickle, Bobby Labonte, and Derek Cope. And then 16 through 20, Phil Parsons, Dale Jarrett, Michael Waltrip, Bill Elliott, and Rick Mass. Jerry Punch is with the victim of our latest crash, Hut Strickland.
Well, a bite has been taken out of his Big Mac Thunderbird here, Hut. Fortunately, you look to be okay. What happened out there?
Well, Jerry, me and a 24 car, Jeff Gordon, were running nose to tail there coming off turn four, and he got against me a little bit coming off turn four, and, you know, you're running so fast here, it really don't take a whole lot. But, yeah, that's really a shame. Mr. McDonald's Thunderbird was really running good tonight. We felt like we had a shot at him, but just wasn't to be.
It's hard to believe the fuel cell is still in this car. The damage of the rear is so extensive.
It certainly is. I'll tell you, the good Lord was deviling with us tonight, keeping that fuel cell from exploding. You know, to look at that thing, there's no excuse why it shouldn't have exploded other than the good Lord is watching over us.
And indeed he was. Let's show the fans at home exactly what we're talking about here. We turn our camera around and our lights. Look at the fuel cell up underneath the car. It actually folded up underneath the back of the car. Give you an idea of how well these cars are built. Here's the bar that protects the fuel cell and protected that fuel cell from rupturing, which could have been a very, very tragic consequence. But NASCAR rules make these bars protect the fuel cell. It all folded in as it's supposed to. And subsequently, we have a driver A-OK and a clean racetrack. As Green gets ready to come back out, let's go back upstairs.
You ever seen anything like that, guys?
Yeah, I've seen things like that. But I tell you, Jerry Punch did a great job explaining to the fans exactly what happened.
Green flag is out. Rusty Wallace is up front. Mark Martin, Jeff Bodine, Rusty Wallace in the record.
And evidently, Ernie Irvin lost a lap somewhere along the way. He was up there. He had been in the lead lap, but he was up there beside of Rusty Wallace, so he must have lost a lap during that pit stop.
Now he's positioned between Wallace and Martin. And a lap down as we ride with Jeff Bodine.
Right behind the Valvoline Ford, they made a chassis adjustment. Watch the telemetry. How many RPM? I saw 8,300. I saw 124 miles an hour. Let's see. 129 miles per hour down the front stretch for the Motorcraft Ford.
If we watch that telemetry, let me correct myself. Ernie lost a lap when he spun out over there. That's how he got the lap behind. But he had always been starting at the rear of the field, but they have to wait to start lapping cars.
And oh, 18 just flew. Looks like he just flew. There's smoke out of the back of the car, and he's very, very slow, Ned.
Yeah, he worked his way up to 17th position from 33rd. But
he'll take the car to the backstretch pits as Dale Earnhardt continues to weave his way through the field.
He's right behind Lake Speed. Lake Speed not qualified 21st. And here we see Ricky Rudd getting alongside of Jeff Bodine. They're right behind Ernie Irvin.
This is the battle for third.
And here comes Brad Bodine. They're going to try to go three abreast.
And Ricky chose the wrong thing. Yep. He went behind Irvin, and that was a wrong move.
Yeah, Irvin moved down to let him go. He was giving him the racing room up there, but that cost Ricky a couple of positions.
So now we have Wallace, Martin, and the Bodine brothers, Jeff and Brett, and then Rudd is fifth.
Right now, Rusty Wallace is pulling away, and John Kernan, what happened to Dale Jarrett in the Interstate Battery Chevrolet?
Well, Benny, what they're doing is tighten the valve cover on the right side of the engine. The motor is still running, so that it did not blow up. It was a big puff of smoke, as everyone could see, but the motor is still running. Now they're looking around. Apparently, Jimmy Makar and the crew have found a leak around the right valve cover. Now they're going to tighten that down, try and get that cleaned up. They're still steering into the engine compartment, and you can smell burning oil.
And on the racetrack, Dale Earnhardt is intimidating his way past another car. He came up on the back of Lake Speed and gave him a little bit of a bump and moved right around him in the next corner.
And he's pulling away from Lake Speed by a couple of car lengths. That's Jimmy Hensley, the Family Channel car directly behind Lake Speed, Morgan Shepherd. And that other car is Dick Trickle in the Dirt Devil Pontiac, the car that's normally driven by Kenny Wallace.
Dale Earnhardt started 19th. The 20th lap, he had moved up to 15th, then 11th, then back to 12th, and now at the end of 102 circuits, he is up to 9th place. And John Kernan has a report.
Bob, before that last pit stop, Dale Earnhardt had been complaining to Andy Petrie and the crew that his car had a terrible push. Till they took a round of bite out of that last pit stop, and apparently they have gotten the problem fixed because Earnhardt seems to be very pleased with the car and the way it's running right now.
And right behind him, Blake Speed has a good race going also.
Dale Jarrett is back on the racetrack in the Interstate Battery Chevrolet. When it puffed smoke and he slowed dramatically, I thought the thing had blown up, and we can see that.
Right behind Dale Earnhardt, he started 21st, fell back to 29th by the 25th lap, then began his march to the front. On the 50th lap was at 18th. He's now in the top 10. Here's Morgan Shepherd and Jimmy Hensley running together on the racetrack.
Hensley pulled right up behind Morgan.
Looking out the back glass at the Citgo 4 driven by Morgan Shepherd.
I guess the antenna that we're seeing on the back of the Citgo 4 is for radio communication between Morgan and the pit crew.
Yeah, they have a little different radio setup than most of the other teams down there have. They run down and use that aerial.
And look at Dick Trickle. He's closed up right on the back bumper of Hensley. I say on the back bumper, folks, I'm talking about on the back bumper.
Having a good run in the Dirt Devil Pontiac.
And see the Sabatis is looking around for a sponsor, and Hensley goes up the hill just a little bit. Trickle, that's all he needed was an opening, takes the spot away. But Felix Sabatis, the car owner of the 40 car, is looking for a sponsor next year, 1994, because Dirt Devil has asked to be released from their obligation. And Felix has said, okay. So they're going away, and he doesn't have anybody. We can see the interval between third, back two. That wasn't third place. Back to this group. That's the next position. Kyle Petty.
That's fourth, fifth, sixth, and seventh right there.
Huh.
Brett. Oh, and here's Kyle Petty moving inside and passing Jeff Gordon with these.
There again, Gordon did put up too much resistance. We saw Kyle coming up. Kyle was fast. He got a little bit of a run on, so he let him go.
Here's the battle for fourth as Rudd looks to the inside of Brett Bodine in the Quaker State Ford. We have completed 114 laps. It's still Rusty Wallace taking command over Mark Martin, Jeff Bodine, Brett Bodine, and Ricky Rudd.
A noble warrior advised.
The ESPN Speed World proud to welcome you to Bristol International Raceway, and here's an interval leaderboard. Rusty Wallace has a 3.18 second advantage on Jeff Bodine, and he did take second from Mark Martin a lap or so ago. Mark is 3.5 seconds back. Kyle Petty continues the march forward. He's 5 seconds behind the leader, and Ricky Rudd, fifth. He is 5.23 seconds behind Rusty Wallace. In Jeff Bodine's car, looking back on the rest of the field.
And I tell you, Mark Martin, on that last pit stop, they made a chassis adjustment, and his car, Jerry Punch, doesn't appear as it's running like it did before the caution flag and the pit stop.
Well, what they did, Benny, actually, the car was very, very loose. They put around a bite in the car, but it has not improved. And just recently, Marcus calls that the car is getting looser and looser, and the crew said, well, try to hang on. I think Mark would like to pit. The crew would like to get a yellow flag if they can see some debris on the racetrack, but as yet we have seen no yellow. And Mark Martin is definitely battling an ill-handling machine.
He's just losing spots right and left. There goes Jeff Gordon past him. He's now back to about eighth position after running second just four or five laps ago.
We see Martin's all the way back there again. That's about seventh or eighth spot. And he is just trying to get his car keep the car going straight. Don't bend it up until he can make a pit stop and make some adjustments.
We're at the one-quarter mark of this event, 125 laps completed. the 28 car of Lake Speed was able to pass Dale Earnhardt a lap ago.
Looks like Earnhardt's car is pretty good on cold tires, but after they run about 30 or 40 laps, then he becomes a car that probably an 8th or 10th class car. Jerry Punch, have you learned anything more about the 6 car?
Well, Martin is radio to Cruz, and it feels like he might have a loose wheel. He said the thing is vibrating so bad, and they're trying to hold on. He has backed down the pace considerably. You see now Lake Speed and Dale Earnhardt go by. They are going to bring Martin in. They cannot take a chance on losing a race car and possibly injuring a driver. So here on lap 128 of the Budweiser 500, our pole sitter has problems and will head down pit road at 35 miles per hour. What a tough break for a man whose operation, his race team, has been bulletproof in most of the months of August. Right side and left side tires. The crew could not determine which side it was, so to be safe, they will change all 4 tires. Right side tires going on. Left side runs up. And he is down and away. And the lug nuts on the left side were taken loose.
So he loses a lap as the others remain at speed. Lost 2 laps.
Lost 2 laps.
Yeah, it's hard to make a green flag pit stop here as fast as you go around this track and not lose more than 1 lap. He did lose 2 laps. There's Lake Speed and the Robert Yates Haviland Ford. As we mentioned, he passed Dale Earnhardt 2 laps ago. Now he's up working on Harry Gant. So Speed getting the feel of that Ford on the move.
This is a battle for 7th position. 7th, 8th, and 9th as they lap Dave Marcus. Here's an Autolite field summary where your favorite driver was running just 1 lap ago.
Morgan Shepard back in the 10th spot.
And Shepard did a fine job in relief of Kenny Wallace.
Still 19 cars in the lead lap. Of course, now they're showing Mark Martin 1 lap down. I'm pretty sure he lost 2 laps on that.
He did lose 2 laps. Now he's 1 down because Mark Martin just blew by him. As we see, Lake Speed has gotten by Harry again. Now Earnhardt goes by again. Harry did not contest him that much. Let him go by.
Gant drops back to 9th.
Mark Martin did pass Rusty Wallace. Of course, that now he is only 1 lap down. 1 7/8.
Yeah, right. 1 7/8. And I think 7/8 being the optimum word there.
Well, Jerry is now down in Mark Martin's pit. How's that tire look that they took off his car, Jerry?
Absolutely frightening, Bob. Let me show you how lucky Mark Martin was. This is the right rear tire. He thought he had a vibration. Let me show you how bad a vibration he had. This tire was working its way loose, the studs moving back and forth. The wheel already beginning to crack here under the tremendous G-force. Maybe a lap and a half, this tire would have come apart, the wheel would have separated, and that car would have gone headlong into the concrete wall here at about 135 miles an hour. A very lucky crew and race driver here in the Valvoline pit.
Not lucky, pretty intelligent
to come in. Yeah, very smart to feel that and to come in. A couple of cars that have been behind the wall for a long time. Rick Wilson in the STP Pontiac is back out, 118 laps down. And Sterling Marlin has pulled the Ray Bestis Ford back out on the racetrack as well.
There is Kyle Petty and Jeff Bodine.
That's the second place. That is the second place car. Now, Kyle Petty has worked himself up into second place.
That car is really working, and here's how he got second from Jeff.
Comes off the corner. Jeff Bodine goes up the hill a little bit, and Kyle Petty just drives right on by. You're right. Kyle Petty has a mellow yellow Pontiac working, and I don't think Felix Sabatis is here tonight.
Really?
They might not let Felix come back anymore.
He is the fastest car on the racetrack.
It's been a steady move to the front from a 20th starting position to 12th, then 7th, and now at the end of 142 laps, he is running in second position.
And he's gaining on Rusty Wallace.
He sure is. And he's been good on the short tracks this year. He's 5th at Richmond, 3rd at Bristol, 2nd at North Wilkesboro, and 5th at Martinsville. Has 4 top 5 finishes in the first half of the 93 short track season.
Maybe these Pontiacs like the short tracks.
Because Rusty Wallace drives a Pontiac. He's leading the race. Yep. Kyle Petty running 2nd. He also in a Pontiac. Look how high Rusty was there, Ned.
Yeah, his car is not handling as good right now as it was earlier.
Rusty Wallace continues to lead this race. We'll see if Kyle Petty is closing in on him when we return with more live action at the Bud 500. Back at Bristol International Raceway, where Rusty Wallace continues to lead this race, but he is in a lot of traffic. That is Dave Marcus, the blue number 71, and Kyle Petty is catching him. Now, just a couple of laps.
What is he catching him? He's caught him. Bob, pay attention.
Just a couple of laps ago, he was a second and a half behind, but now, yep, right there.
I tell you what, this traffic, Mark Martin, when he was going through this traffic while we were on break, I noticed he was losing a lot of ground to Rusty Wallace, and I thought maybe he was slowing down, but then I looked and I said, it must be the traffic, and we can see just how much trouble that Kyle Petty is having getting through this traffic.
John Kernan is in Kyle Petty's pit on the backstretch, John. Good run for Kyle.
You know, Bob, a lot of the drivers in that final afternoon practice session all complained that their cars were too loose, so you saw a lot of teams in the final couple hours before the race started making changes to the chassis, tightening the car up. Well, Robin Pemberton thought that the track, when it cooled off and the sun went down, the track would just naturally tighten up, so they did not change anything on Kyle's car, and apparently they made the right decision.
Yeah, I think you could say that, although, again, the interval begins to lengthen out just a little bit because of the movement through traffic, but Kyle is doing fine in the mellow yellow Pontiac.
There he is. There's Rusty Wallace, the leader of the race, the Miller Genuine Draft Pontiac, and there is the, now we've got traffic again. That's Bill Elliott and Bobby Hillen directly in front of Rusty.
Well, you can see there are cars all around the track and some good battles going on.
Look at the 28 car. Went low to pass Michael Waltrip and now goes high to take off Sterling Marlin.
See the front end sheet metal off of the car number 8 of Sterling Marlin.
And Kyle Petty has taken the lead.
Petty passes Rusty Wallace in turn 4 and becomes our third leader of the evening.
Now he's got to get by Bill Elliott, and that may be what caused Rusty Wallace to lead. No, Elliott moves up and lets the guys go. Now Rusty goes alongside. So Kyle Petty started 21st, now has the lead.
And here's how he got it from Rusty.
There we see Bill Elliott and Bobby Hillen. Rusty went in the corner. Looks like he might have gotten a little bit loose as he went in the corner, went up the hill, and all Kyle Petty needed was just a small open, and away he went.
Bill Elliott is running in 18th place, so that means there are 17 cars left on the lead lap.
I think Elliott may have been a little bit loose there, too, and Rusty backed off because of it, which
that could be.
Yeah, which allowed Kyle to take the lead. There's Elliott.
Pull away from Rusty Wallace. There's a race between the two rookie cars. This 40 car would normally be driven by Kenny Wallace, the rookie, and Bobby Labonte, the McElhouse car.
This is for 11th position as Bobby Labonte, who began this race from 4th, has now fallen back to 12th, but would like to pass Dick Trickle for 11th.
They're right in front of Jimmy Hensley, the Family Channel car, whose car went away just a little bit.
Oh, boy, Trickle's really loose coming off the corner.
Yeah, he got the back end loose, but boy, he's had cars in that position many, many times in his career, so he knew how to bring her back.
Labonte took a look, but Dave Marcus was there. What's the STG on the side of Marcus's car? Anybody know? About to get that sponsor plug, but I don't remember what it is.
Yeah, he has told me, and I can't remember either. I apologize.
He also has a local sponsorship on that car, Tri-City Aviation.
Yes. You know, Dave Marcus in the 71 car went to the test at Indianapolis for the two-day test and got some local sponsors for the test at Indy. A Chevrolet dealer and
Young Chevrolet in Indianapolis.
And there we see.
Now
Trickle finally just moves over and says, go ahead. And here comes Hensley. Said, you go ahead too.
Mark coming up on that group.
Mark is still one lap down. He lost two but got one back.
He's about 1 and 5/8 lap down now.
was pulled away from the leader.
Now, Martin would love to see to run and make, let the other guys make a pit stop on the green flag and then have the caution flag come out. What the heck? He might end up leading the race again.
Yep, that could put him right back up front, no doubt about it.
He drives around Trickle.
And Dave Marcus tries to get around Trickle, and Trickle once again lost that back end coming off the corner.
Mark Martin has already led this race. He'll pick up the 5 bonus points. And this is the 15th out of the 21 races that we have been involved in this year that he has led at least one lap.
Kyle Petty just passed Phil Parsons, who was running 15th. So now only 14 cars in the lead lap.
Another good battle for position here involves the 15 of Jeff Bodine, the 5 of Rudd, and the 24 of Jeff Gordon. And Jeff trying to move to the inside of Ricky.
That's 3rd, 4th, 5th, and 6th, as we saw Lake Speed right behind the DuPont Chevy.
There's Lake. Robert Gates, Adelman Ford.
As we watch this, Kenny Schrader in the Kodiak Chevrolet, you just saw the glimpse of the top of this car. There it goes. Back on the racetrack, minus the front end.
Riding with Jeff Gordon, now looking back on Jeff.
And Ricky Rudd.
Rudd.
And folks, that track is not nearly as flat as it looks from the camera.
By 36 degrees. As Bob Jenkins said earlier, the steepest bank in NASCAR Winston Cup Racing. Look at it bounce. Look at that right front bounce.
Right.
It goes up right behind Jeff Gordon.
All this happening while Kyle Petty continues to lead this race.
Kyle is pulled away from Rusty Wallace. This is the best race on the track.
Did you see Rudd comes off the corner very well, closes up on the back. We'll see what kind of RPM and speed he's running down the straightaway now. We saw 129 miles an hour before down the straightaway. This time, only 116. So the tires are getting hot, slick. He's not able to get on the throttle back in the corner. Get up to speed like he was before.
And he's on the brake right there to go into the corner.
It's a little bit heavy there, the traffic. Here goes Rudd down on the inside of the Derek Coate car.
Oh, it's a contact, and Coate spins Jeff Gordon. Spin, and the caution is out.
And Gordon bumps the wall before he can save it. Both cars are at the top of the banking in turn one. Jeff Gordon and Derek Coate. Now they begin to drive away, but here comes Kyle Petty. And Jeff has some damage there to the left rear of the car.
The left foot tire is flat.
It's like both of them.
And that's the underneath of the car is dragging. That's what's dragging, making all the sparks.
Yeah, both left tires are flat.
Yeah.
He had a good run going. He was running fourth, but look at the contact coming off 4.
Yeah, he and Derek Coate make some contact, now, and he runs
speed.
Up on top of the car.
Yeah, look at Lake Speed. He gets slowed down, doesn't know which way to go. He just keeps her slow and then goes to the inside, makes a good move down to the inside, out of harm's way.
And from another angle,
this is from high on top, and we can see just a little bit of contact between Gordon and Derek Coate.
Just a real great job of driving there by Lake Speed. Jerry Punch is down with Rusty Wallace.
They have already changed the right side tires, now changing the left side tires. He is down to the right. Right behind Rusty Wallace, they have brought the DuPont Chevrolet of Jeff Gordon in with extensive damage to the front end of the car. Let's check in the back pit now with John Furner, where Kyle Petty is pitting.
Jerry, the race leader has already got right side tires. A very, very fast pit stop in. But Rusty Wallace now swings by. No chassis adjustment, but Jeff Bodine will beat Kyle out. It looks like Kyle will have to settle for about third. Lake Speed, Dale Earnhardt, Dick Trickle all head down pit road.
Well, I don't know, John, that Kyle Petty went across that white line before Jeff Bodine, but now we'll see how NASCAR shakes that up. and see how that works.
I think that's the way. I think that he would be in third place or second place, maybe.
From Jeff Gordon's in-car camera. It sounded and looked from Jeff's perspective as he was involved in the incident with Derek Cope. He came in for some work on the car and now brings the car in for a second time as we are under our fifth caution of the evening. 180 laps are completed in the Bud 500. ESPN Speed World welcomes you back to Bristol International Raceway in Northeast Tennessee for the Bud 500, our annual visit to this half-mile facility under the lights. Here's the pit summary. Kyle Petty was first when he went in, came out third. Remember, he's pitting on the backstretch. Rusty Wallace went from second to first. Jeff Bodine third to second. Rudd stayed at fourth, and Lake Speed stayed at fifth. And Jeff Gordon is in another time, Jerry.
Well, he has some significant sheet metal damage in the right front of his Chevrolet Lumina. The DuPont colors having been crunched somewhat, but that's not the primary problem he has right now. A moment ago, they brought him in, and NASCAR held him one lap here in the pits. They said, I just spoke with a NASCAR official who told me that he was being penalized for running the stop sign at the end of pit road. So they brought him back in and held him a lap. Now, once he leaves, he will also be made to go to the tail end of the longest line. That's because he pitted the first time by, and he had lost a lap on the racetrack. And instead of pitting with the lap cars, he pitted the first time by with the lead lap cars. So he will have to go to the tail end of the longest line. So a couple of penalties, and suddenly Jeff Gordon goes from a victory contender to a big, long afternoon, a long evening here at Bristol, Tennessee.
And he's got a badly damaged race car also. Here's a replay as we watch the work on the right front of the car. Here's a replay of what happened when he came up, Derek Cope.
He's going down the back straightaway into turn three. He'll get alongside of it in turn four.
And there's the contact between the two. Jeff fighting the wheel, trying to keep it off the wall, but boom, there's the hit that Jeff Gordon experienced. And speaking of hits, did you like that? Kirby Puckett and the Twins will go against the Chicago White Sox in the Sunday Night Baseball here on ESPN. That at 8 o'clock tomorrow night, the Twins and the White Sox on ESPN Sunday Night Baseball. We'll take another break and be right back with more from Bristol. Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, John Kernan, Dr. Jerry Punch back at Bristol with 189 laps complete, and there is our leader, Rusty Wallace. Behind him is Mark Martin, who's a lap down, then the second place car of Kyle Petty.
Kyle moved around, Jeff Bodine a few laps ago, taking over the second place. So that Pontiac is still fast.
You know that Mark Martin would like to get up there and get his lap back. Already made up one. Here's Jeff Bodine. There's Ricky Rudd.
Phil Parsons of Mannheim Auto Auction car. He's a lap down.
And then right behind Phil is the 28 car of Lake Speed.
He is in fifth position. Have a good run.
And in sixth, Dale Earnhardt. Started 19th.
He had that good Rick Chevrolet up to sixth spot.
John Kernan, any problems with that three car that you're aware of?
Well, they made up positions with a very fast pit stop under 20 seconds. Now, the problem, potential problem, the spotter has told Andy Petrie that on that last green flag run before the caution came out, Earnhardt's right front brake rotor was glowing red. The car was pushing so badly in the turn that Earnhardt had to get on the brakes, and he was heating up that rotor. So they made another chassis adjustment, and we'll have to watch that to see if that right front rotor continues to glow bright red.
We'll watch that. It should be quite evident in the ninth time here at Bristol.
Oh, Kyle Petty gets sideways and spins down the front straightaway.
Hit the wall hard. He just hit the end of the pit wall. I thought he was going to maybe survive, but nope. The mellow yellow Pontiac came in hard contact with the pit wall, and Kyle tries to get the car going again.
And Mark Martin did not get his lap back. Kyle was trying to pass Mark Martin as it came off the fourth corner and just got the car out of shape.
And again, heavy damage to that car at the back end of it. It occurs on lap 197, and here it is in replay.
As Benny said, he was trying to move on the inside of Mark Martin and gets the car out of shape, tries to straighten it out, but couldn't do it, so he looped it, spun it down in there, and he locked about 12 feet getting by the end of that wall.
And at the same time, there was an incident on the backstretch that we were not aware of, but let's see what happened. That's Bobby Labonte and Derek Cope there side by side.
Going in turn three. Cope goes up, smacks the wall, and hits it again just a little bit. Comes right down in the middle of traffic.
Dave Marcus was aware of what was going on and managed to miss him. Cope is in the pits as they change tires on that car. This is the sixth caution of the evening. The record here is 20. There is the reason for the most recent caution. Kyle Petty in an accident here on the front stretch.
It does not look very good for the Mellow Yellow team, Bob. They've got a lot of work to do. That's a trailing arm from the right rear. When he hit the wall, it bent the trailing arm, so they had to pull him behind the wall. They'll also have to change the spring. He bent the right rear tire. They've got a lot of work to do for Kyle, who is obviously sitting in the car. He is okay, but he is just very, very unhappy about what happened.
Well, he certainly did hit the wall hard enough. We're glad to hear he's okay. Let's hope they can get the car back in competition, but he no longer is a factor to win this race as he once was.
Look, right now, it looks like it's between Rusty Wallace or Mark Martin, and Mark Martin's a lap down, so Jeff Bodine just cannot muster enough strength to get up there and race with those guys, it does appear.
Here's an Autolite field summary.
Cars in the lead lap now. Mark Martin back up to 13th. See a good minute there, just one lap down. But then Wally Dahlenbach was behind the wall for a while. He's 30 laps down. Dale Jarrett is behind the wall now. They say he might have a transmission problem. Jimmy Spencer is back out now. We've taken the out away from him because he's back out on the racetrack.
There is Lake Speed moving to the inside of.
Dale Earnhardt comes up with Goodrich Chevrolet. He's trying to chase down Lake Speed. He goes by Phil and sets his eyes and his sights on the Havilland Texaco car,
which is running in fourth place. Earnhardt now up to fifth. So of the top five in the point standings, Dale Jarrett is the one that's getting hurt the most so far tonight. Rusty Wallace was third, so he's having a great night. Earnhardt leading, of course, and he's having a good night as well. That's in the top five. Morgan Shepherd still out there running good. He's is in fifth place, and Mark Martin was in fourth place in the points. He's still running good left down.
Lake Speed started 21st, currently fourth. That's his highest. His lowest has been 32nd, and not yet has he led a lap.
Well, he wasn't involved in a crash over there and went to fifth. That's right. That's the early part of the crash. We've had six so far, folks.
Now here's Rudd putting some pressure on Jeff Bodine. This is for second spot.
Folks, I thought he was going to be excited. I didn't lie to you.
You don't have to give the money back.
I don't have to give any money back. That's right.
Jeff Bodine having a great run here tonight. He came into this race with nine straight finishes of 12th or worse, but he's turned it around and is running second. Looking back from his car onto Ricky Rudd and Lake Speed, and look at this. Oh, Morgan Shepherd and Jimmy Hensley. Shepherd passes.
That's coming off the fourth corner, going down in turn one.
And that was for eighth position.
Now here comes Bobby Labonte trying to get by Hensley. This is for position.
Hensley's now back in ninth. Jeff Gordon is still out there, but he was involved in a crash that has rendered his car uncompetitive. And once again, Rudd now closes right in on Jeff Bodine, but as he looks in his rearview mirror, he's got late speed right there.
Said, you want to play offense or defense right now, Ricky? So you go either way.
That's right. And Dale Earnhardt is also right in thick of things.
Second through fifth. We're looking at the third place car out the rear window of the second place car. Yes, they're down.
Watch his rug closing right up on the back bumper. Both these drivers take a beating, a physical beating. When this thing is over, the driver, the winning driver, will want to sit down and rest before he does anything else.
Bristol is one of the several racetracks that Benny and Ned have both won on. Of course, Ned's came many years ago, and Benny several years ago and several pounds ago. The leader continues to be Rusty Wallace as we have completed 217 of the 500 laps in the Mud 500. ESPN Speed World is being brought to you by Allied Signals Ram Filters. You can pay a little now or a lot later. By Budweiser, fresh, pure, natural, proud to be your Bud. And by Armor All, there's a fountain of youth and we own the patent. Rusty Wallace is leading the Bud 500.
But Mark Martin, folks, he's trying to get that lap back.
This is not for the lead. Mark lost two laps earlier when he had to make an unscheduled pit stop. He lost, he's gained a lap
here
back.
Here he comes.
Now he's about to gain his second lap back. He does. Mark Martin is back on the lead.
Wait,
lap.
Wait a little, Rusty, something really slowed down there, fellas.
I think he just scared Rusty so much.
Well, okay.
Well, that Ford dove in there beside of him.
Well, looks like everything's okay, but... Well, the crew is saying that everything's okay with the car. He just had to back out of the gas to the point where it looked like that he was slowing down.
Well, it did there for a moment, but that's good smart driving on his part. Once Mark got around him, but the second-place car is pretty far back.
Yeah.
About two-thirds of the straightaway, so he didn't have to worry about him at the moment, so not take any chances.
Rusty Wallace leads as far as points scored at Bristol over the last 5 years. He has 9 top tens, including 3 wins in 11 races. By the way, while we watch Rusty, we'll tell you that Darrell Waltrip, who was involved in one of the earlier crashes, is back on the racetrack. This is the 98 car of Derek Cope. Rusty Wallace started this race from the outside of the front row in second position. His lowest position so far has been third on lap 4, and he has led 153 laps of the 229.
I think that little snapshot tells us that Rusty Wallace is running very, very well tonight.
I think that pretty much tells the story, doesn't it?
Yes, it does.
Just as I tell you that Darrell Waltrip was back on the track, he's back behind the wall. Here's a good battle still with between Jeff Bodine and Ricky Rudd.
And they might be gaining on the leader, Rusty Wallace. I don't think they're losing any ground.
Yeah, it seems after Rusty runs about 40 or 50 laps on new tires, then the car sort of goes away. Certainly doesn't run as fast, but not in comparison to the other cars. Seems like it goes away a little bit more than some of the others.
This is second, third, and fourth right here. Jeff Bodine, Ricky Rudd, and the 28 car of
Lake Speed. Rudd has been up beside of Jeff Bodine a couple of times, but he'd run up on a lap car and had to back out of it. He's worked hard trying to move around it, but just can't quite do it. As we said at the top of the show, this is a tough racetrack to pass on. But Kyle Petty and several others have proven you can pass on it if you got the best enough race car.
And you got to also give a call to Lake Speed, who once again is giving that 28 car a fine run in his pre previous performance here at Bristol. He has 2 7th-place finishes in his 12 previous performances. Here's the telemetry again. We'll see how, well, 124, I think, was about the peak there.
And it's down to 98 miles an hour. Before, the car didn't get below 100 miles an hour. Top speed of 125, and we saw 129. So, once again, the tires are getting hot, getting worn, and the cars are slowing down.
We're approaching the halfway point. We're on lap 237 now. 13 more circuits, which will go by very quickly. We will reach the 250 halfway point. Look at that car dancing off the corner.
I'm telling you, this car's taking a tremendous strain as it goes in the corner. The G-load, I don't know how much it is, because I'd have to talk to anybody that's been here with a computer in the car to tell me, but has to be as high as any racetrack that we go to.
Were the banks this high when you raced your name?
No. No, I think they were about maybe 4 degrees or something like that when the track was first built. 22 degrees.
But they were when you raced.
Yes, they were. And, you know, they banked this racetrack in, like, 1969 or 70. And this racetrack is fashioned after Dayton, Ohio, Salem, Indiana, Winchester,
yep.
Indiana.
Yep.
Some of those high bank tracks that the midgets and sprints ran on up in the Midwest.
Yep. Often seen on Saturday night thunders.
Morgan Shepherd has just moved around Brett Bodine and taken over the 6th position.
Lake Speed again is all over Ricky Rudden, and I think we should mention also that you had relief during your win here at Bristol.
John A. Utzman.
Yep. I saw John down at the pitch yesterday.
I did too, so he and his brother. John A. is still racing. We're about the same age, and I told him he's nuts, but he
still races anyway.
Still races anyway, that's right. It's going to make a lot of difference.
We'll watch the telemetry as we see again out the back glass of Jeff Bodine's car back onto Ricky Rudd and how it looks from the spectator's standpoint in the grandstand. Oh, really tight racing. That's a pretty nice shot.
Yeah, it is. Back to 96 miles an hour. He accelerates off the corner and the RPM builds.
125, that's nice.
As we watch this, once again, Wally Donovan has slowed, heading for pit road. Jeff Bodine doesn't use a whole lot of brakes on that car.
No.
John Curtin was talking about Earnhardt had a rotor that was cheering red, but didn't look like the Bodine was using a great deal of brakes.
He's pulled away a little bit now from Ricky Rudd. You can see that distance that's opened up.
We are now 4 laps away from the halfway point, and things have kind of settled down here after 5 make that 6 caution flags in the first half of the race. But Rusty Wallace has been, for the most part, the dominant driver, although Mark Martin has also led, and he is now back on the lead lap. It's Wallace, Jeff Bodine, Ricky Rudd, Lake Speed, and Dale Earnhardt in front of a sellout crowd here at Bristol. This is the night, and it's so far the first half provided all the thrills and excitement that we expected. Those overhead shots that you're seeing are from the Blockbuster video blimp. And as I mentioned earlier, Mats Backlund, and I hope I pronounced that correctly. Anyway, he's from Sweden, and he is the pilot of the blimp tonight.
Is that the same as Sweden?
Yeah. Okay. I don't know whether he flew the thing over here from Sweden or not. I kind of doubt it. Here's a good battle, Rick Mast and Jimmy Hensley, and this would be 4-10.
10th spot, Mast has it, and Hensley is trying to take it away, or maybe Mast just took it away.
Yeah, Mast just moved around Jimmy Hensley and took it away. Both of those drivers having a good night here tonight. Now, they're about 3/4 of a lap behind leader Rusty Wallace. In fact, Mark Martin is coming up on them to challenge them for position. 13 cars in the lead lap. That's 10 and 11 we're seeing there. And behind them is Dick Trickle in the Dirt Devil Pontiac. He is 12th and Mark Martin is 13th.
So I'm sure that the crews have radioed to their drivers and said, look, you got to get moving if you can because the leader is gaining.
Mr. Wallace has just put Bill Elliott another lap down and Budweiser Ford. That makes Bill two laps down. He is being shown in 16th position.
There's that good battle for second spot.
Oh, Lake had a run that time.
And he may have run.
He does.
Yes. Lake moves to third spot. Second is Jeff Modine. Then Lake Speed and Ricky Rudd. Well, here's our Western Auto Race summary. Rusty Wallace has led 178 of the first 255 laps with 13 cars on the lead lap. 3 leaders, 5 lead changes, 6 caution flags for a total of 41 laps, and the average speed is 84.77 miles an hour. Those that have picked up the 5 bonus points for leading lap, just 3 so far. Rusty Wallace, Mark Martin, and Kyle Petty. Out of the race, Hunt Strickland because of an incident, an accident. The same with Terry Labonte, Bobby Hamilton, and Dale Jarrett is also behind the wall now of the race. Our Western Auto Mechanic of the Year standings. Andy Petrie from Dale Earnhardt's crew is on top. Steve Meehl second, followed by Tony Glover, Frank Edwards, and Buddy Parrott is fifth in the Western Auto Mechanic of the Year standings.
Jeff Modine is about 3.25 seconds behind Rusty Wallace. And in fact, he's picked up a little bit in the last 2 laps. It could be because of traffic.
While we have an opportunity here, I'd like to mention the 4 drivers that did not make the race and had to fall out and leave here. Ted Musgrave did not make it. Todd Bodine, Rich Bickle, and P.J. Jones. Those 4 drivers were unable to make the race. And as many of you know, Todd Bodine won last night's Food City 250 Busch Grand National race. Another Napa field summary for you. Now they were running last lap.
Phil Parsons up there on the outside of Lake Speed moves over and gives him plenty of running room. Phil in the Mannheim Auto Auction car in 17th position.
2 laps down, he, Bobby Hill, and Phil Elliott all racing together. And there's the guys that have been involved in some crashes other than Dale Jarrett. He hasn't been in any crash, but he's had some kind of problem, and he's been in and out of the pits all night.
Yeah, he's been behind the wall quite a while now. Evidently, he's through for the night, isn't he?
Still, this contest for second, third, and fourth position is the best one. We're looking back from Jeff Bodine's car on the Lake Speed, Ricky Rudd, and now Dale Earnhardt.
There we are, 2, 3, 4, 5.
There's Parsons.
There's the 6th place car, Morgan Shepherd. Then Brett Bodine.
7.
Then Harry Gant. Now here's a good battle. Dick Trickle now has caught the car number 7 of Jimmy Hensby. And Mark Martin has caught them.
Oh, and Trickle spins. This could be the caution flag that
Mark Martin.
And they do throw it. Mark Martin is going to get a lap back.
Oh, and the clock thickens.
Because he is the only one that has shown enough speed to run with Rusty Wallace tonight that he finally gets that lap back.
Yeah, this could be a very significant development in that race. That spin by Dick Trickle on the backstretch brings out the caution, allows Mark Martin to encircle the entire about 3/4 of the racetrack. And now we could have a real shootout.
Here we go. Trickle gets underneath the 7 car, turns the car, hits the gas, and around he goes. And Mark Martin, if Trickle went up the hill, Martin wouldn't have to worry about racing anymore tonight because he would have been out.
There was no contact between the two. Looks like that Dick just lost control coming off the corner. Here's Jerry Bunch.
Taking a look at Rusty Wallace and crew. Now, Buddy Parrott cleaning the rubber from the front of the grill. Rubber buildup could be a problem on the short track as far as the car overheating. That's across the wall. Right side tires going on the Miller Genuine Draft Pontiac. Now, left side tires. You're watching 15 on the bottom. That is Jeff Bodine, Motorcraft Ford, getting service on pit road. Rusty Wallace, left side tires. 15 is down and out. As the 2 comes down and out, they race back to turn 1. As activity continues over in the backstretch, here is John Kernan.
Lake Speed is in. Right side tires are already on. They will take a quarter turn to red wedge out of the right rear. They're going to try and loosen it up a little bit. There goes Rusty Wallace. Also, Jeff Bodine already out. The left sides are on. Lake Speed guns the engine, heads down. But will he beat Ricky Rudd out? He's on the racetrack.
Yeah, I believe he will. I believe Lake will be able to go into the third. We'll watch that.
I don't know how they do that because the last time Kyle Petty did the Jeff down the cross that line, but evidently they're talking about blending someplace else. I know they're supposed to blend in, and evidently they're not using that white line.
seventh caution of the evening is out here on the 271st lap at the Bud 500. And we'll take a break and be back with more of our live coverage after these messages. ESPN Speed World watches from overhead as the field realigns for a restart. Here's Jerry Punch with a report on pit road just before we go green.
Guys, you commented how well Rusty Wallace runs when he dropped the green flag. After about 20 or 25 laps, he begins to slow down just slightly. The crew has noticed the same thing as well, so they've made an adjustment. 1 pound of air pressure, Bill Wilbur told me, and those tires can make a big difference. And they think they have a little too much pressure in this tire. It's a new tire here, and we'll see if it can be a little more consistent now under a long green flag run. Back upstairs.
Here's the green. Rusty brings him down slowly to get the green flag, and Lake Speed does not beat Ricky Rudd to the line. So Rudd is third, Jeff Bodine second, Speed is fourth, and Morgan Shepherd is fifth. Remember, Mark Martin is back on the lead lap in 10th.
Here's, we see Earnhardt trying to get by the 21 car. Morgan Shepherd, the Citgo Ford, the GM Goodrich Chevrolet.
And when they make their pit stops, Earnhardt was fifth and Shepard was sixth, and Shepard hitting on the front stretch was able to get out in front of us. So now Shepard is fifth and Earnhardt sixth. But right now, Shepard is pulling away from Earnhardt. As late.
Up to the front we go. Here's Bodine trying to put a lap on Bill Elliott. He does. Ricky Rudd will come along.
And we see Dick Trickle, who, when he spun back there, lost the lap. He was in the lead lap until he spun. Now he is a lap down.
Yeah, they're, you know, Bob, they're only 11, 12 cars now in the lead lap. They were 13.
Here's Earnhardt again.
Sixth place.
Brett Bodine is seventh.
Their
lap of the four car, and Ernie Bob, I believe, in our very first caution after taking a provisional to get into this race. It's been a tough and long evening for Ernie Irvin.
He's being shown in 14th position, one lap down. So he has stayed in the same lap. He lost the lap during that spin, but he has not lost any more since then.
There's a sixth car. He's on the way back. He just passed Rick Mast. He's seen tonight that he has one of the better, faster race cars here. Now he has to work his way through this traffic to get back to the front as Earnhardt goes up alongside Bill Elliott. Here comes Brett Bodine. He pulls alongside.
Brett's having a good run. He's seventh.
I tell you, these cars get on the outside. They really struggle. Here again, right behind him is the six car, Mark Martin, driving in fourth.
And Bill Parsons passed Bill Elliott there. That was fourth position.
Bill Elliott has a victory here at Bristol. He won the Food City race in 1988, the spring event. But his problems in 93 continue. He's been on somewhat of a hot streak here recently, but things have not gone particularly well for Bill Elliott tonight.
Of course, Junior Johnson's other car, Pat Strickland, was involved in a crash. Couldn't get out of the race, but he's on board. Here's Martin now working on Harry Gant.
He took a look.
This is the battle for ninth position, and Mark now has it. His highest was, of course, the lead that he had on lap 85, and his lowest, 21st, occurred on lap 176. He led 54 circuits. Now up to ninth.
That was right after he made that pit stop, an unscheduled stop, and lost two laps, changing a right rear tire that the lug nuts had loosened up on.
Right now, Mark Martin is about 5 7/10 seconds behind the Rusty Wallace.
5 7/10. Well, Rusty's going to start running across the traffic. Mark Martin is already pretty heavy traffic, so we'll see how many cars Mark Martin has to go by. There's Phil Parsons. He's a couple laps down to Mark. There's a car in the lead lap, in the same lap. Jimmy Hensley, the Family Channel Ford. There's Ernie Irvin. He's a lap down. And Brett Bodine, another car that he has to pass in the same lap.
Yep, Brett's in seventh position.
Earnhardt's sixth.
Sixth.
right in front of Earnhardt
is Morgan Shepherd, who's fifth.
That's right. And right in front of Morgan Shepherd is a gaggle of cars.
4-3 and 2, Speed, Rudd, and Jeff Bodine.
Dick Trickle, I tell you what, he's hanging with
his
bunch.
Yeah, he sure is.
Hey, Morgan Shepherd is running good.
Yeah.
He was catching that group of cars that we were watching. He was running sixth before that last caution came out, and we were watching that second through fifth place battle that Morgan was gaining on.
And there is the leader.
Rusty Wallace won three short track races earlier this year, wants to start the second half of the 93 season with another win here at Bristol, and so far he has been the man to beat. Blockbuster video blimp bringing us overhead shots of Bristol International Raceway as we are 298 laps into the Bud 500. Jeff Bodine is almost 2 seconds behind leader Rusty Wallace. Ricky Rudd 2.19, Lake Speed 2.69. You can see how those second, third, and fourth place drivers are all stacked up, and not too far behind in fifth is Morgan Shepherd. And this is how close that battle for second and third is. Well, just second now, because Dick Trickle has positioned himself between Rudd and Lake Speed. And Rick Mass passes Jimmy Hensley, and that'll put him in ninth.
Mark Martin has passed these cars and has moved on ahead.
Yeah, he's picking up on Brett Bodine. Will be the next one that he'll have to pass. Martin now being shown in the eighth position.
There he goes. We saw the green car, Brett Bodine, just a glimpse in the left side of our screen. That's the guy that Mark Martin right now is chasing. Ultimately, he's going to chase Rusty Wallace, but one step at a time.
Right. There's Brett, Quaker State Ford.
So what'd we say? It was Martin was how much behind before?
577, wasn't it?
Well, it's 6-3 now.
So he's losing some ground, but I would expect that, having caught that traffic and having to get around that traffic.
Dale Earnhardt is in sixth. And Morgan Shepherd there is in fifth position, and Morgan has had 7 top tens in his last 10 races. There's Lake. There is the battle for second between Jeff Bodine and Ricky Rudd.
The trickle in there, as you said, he's lost a lap and is currently being shown in the 13th position.
Boy, it seems like we have seen this shot a lot tonight, doesn't it?
Just every time we turn around.
And Ricky still hasn't gotten by him.
I don't think he's passed him all night, has he?
I don't think so. Dale Earnhardt comes up to pick off another position, this for fifth, Morgan Shepherd.
Well, Shepherd moves high and lets it go.
Yep. Earnhardt's fifth. And he's not too many car lengths away from Lake Speed in fourth.
By the way, one of our spotters reported that the country time for the number 68, that Greg Sachs had lost a feeling in his hands, and Bobby Hamilton had gotten in the car. Is that right, Jerry?
Oh, look at this.
Finally, he's going to pass him.
Finally, so does Dick Trickle. And now we look out the front of the car to Ricky Rudd instead of out the back glass. All right, Jerry, sorry to interrupt you.
Well, not at all unusual here at Bristol, Tennessee, with the vibration. Greg Sachs has climbed out of the car. We are told that Bobby Hamilton has climbed in the car number 68. So certainly it's been a tough day for that team. Greg Sachs had problems early on in practice, tagged the wall. They have a problem in the back straightaway.
Bobby Labonte has spun, and another caution flag comes out. This is the ninth of the evening, and it comes on lap 310. I didn't see it, did you?
No, I didn't see it either, but Bobby Labonte didn't hit anything. He was the car that spun and made no contact. I think it was similar to the Dick Trickle spin of just a few minutes ago.
Bobby being shown in the 12th position.
He said, Rusty, man, why don't you cut me some slack?
Let's go back and take a look at the pass that Rudd made on Jeff Bodine. This just a few laps ago.
Gets under him, gets the car a little bit sideways, and now they're all headed for pit road.
Rusty Wallace and others are in. Jerry.
Rusty Wallace made a last-minute dash, almost didn't come down pit road, turned hard left, and just missed the end of the pit wall. We're going to show you three different pit stops. Two on the top of your screen. That's Rusty Wallace, the 15. It's Jeff Bodine. And now left side on the 15 car, and left side on the Thai Chevrolet of Ricky Rudd's 15 car. Bodine down pit road. You're now watching Ricky Rudd's crew, the Thai Chevrolet, as he is bound. So all three of the leaders have changed four tires and are headed for turn one. Let's check in with John Turner.
Lake Speed is in. They will make a chassis adjustment on the right rear one and a quarter turns, trying to loosen it up. He finally gets the left side tires on. He heads down pit road. Dale Earnhardt was also in for a four-tire change.
Robert Yates' crew has got Lake Speed out nicely.
And they beat some of the cars out that were pitting on the front stretch, Mark Hart.
And now there's a lot of cars coming in on the back stretch. These are cars that are at least one lap down that have come in, including there's Dick Frickle coming in, Bobby Hillen, and others. 312 laps have been completed. We are under our eighth caution of the evening at Bristol, Tennessee. Field has formed behind the pace car, which has its light out. We are set to go back to green flag racing. It will come out on lap 316. Rusty Wallace is still at the front of the field as the sellout crowd stands and watches the green flag come out. Jeff Bodine second, then Ricky Rudd, Brett Bodine, Morgan Shepherd, Lake Speed, Dale Earnhardt, Mark Martin, Jimmy Hensley, and Rick Mast.
And don't get here again.
And here again.
Now, Harry had slowed a little bit before that caution came out, as if maybe he had lost the cylinder, or maybe he thought he had a tire going down or something, but anyway. He seems to be running okay now.
Well, Harry Gant indeed was slowing down. Jerry, have you determined what might be wrong with that car?
Leo Jackson told me they had a really significant push in the car, and Harry just could not get the car turned. And you don't want to be on the high side here at Bristol when your car won't turn. You'll end up with a face full of concrete. So Harry had to back it down. As we have a little bit of contact in turn one, a lot of smoke out of the Kodak Chevrolet.
And it is pulling to the pits on the backstretch. Smoke coming from behind it. There is tight racing everywhere around here, I'll tell you. Here is Rudd once again trying to take over second from Jeff Bodine.
You mean Jeff Bodine got back in front of him on that caution?
On the pit stop, yep. Here it is. Bud Moore's crew has turned out some good pit stops here tonight in Motocross Ford.
There's how he did it. As we show you a pit summary, Rusty in first, out first, Rudd second to third, Jeff from third to second, Lake Speed from fourth to sixth, and Earnhardt fell from fifth to seventh during that pit stop.
There's a race for second there, the second place car, Jeff Bodine, the Motocross Ford.
Second, third, fourth, fifth, and sixth are right together. We understand that Bobby Labonte, who spun on the backstretch a few laps ago, has notified the pit crew that he isn't feeling well and is seeking relief.
There he is down on the inside, the blue car. Maxwell House Coffee. Four.
This shot looked familiar, Benny.
I'm telling you.
We're back at it.
And folks, we didn't take this shot and just use it over and over and over again. This is actually happening.
Speaking of Bobby Labonte, he is being shown in 14th position.
Rudd passed Jeff Bodine just before the caution blew, and now he's got to do it all again. He almost did that time, but did not. Jerry, what do you hear about Bobby Labonte?
Well, I'm standing beside Terry Labonte, who's now in a Maxwell House uniform. Brother Terry is going to get in the car. They're trying to fit a helmet here in front of Terry. They're getting ready. Let me just ask Terry. Terry, I understand Bobby is ill. I understand Bobby is quite ill.
Yeah, he's not feeling good. I guess the crush panel got knocked out of it, so he's getting sick.
Terry is getting ready to go in the car. Apparently, he is getting some carbon monoxide, and the car is getting very, very queasy on his stomach. Terry is running, got a uniform on. They're trying to fit a radio to the helmet, and as soon as they can get Terry fixed, they will bring Bobby down pit road and change the drivers.
Terry, of course, was eliminated very early on in an accident and has been watching the race from the pit area since that time, and now finds himself in a position to help out his brother Bobby.
Shouldn't be much of an adjustment to make on the seat. Those guys are relatively small, both about the same size.
I tell you what, now we have got ourselves a mess here.
Yeah, we do. 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and 8 are nose and tail.
See those sparks coming out of Rudd's Tide Chevrolet as he goes into turn one, as it bottoms out a little bit going into that turn.
Looking back at Lake Speed. These cars were all bumper to bumper just a moment ago. It seems to have scattered out just a little bit.
Thank goodness. Lake Speed in sixth. Watching for Morgan Shepherd. Sitko Ford on top of it. Now looking behind.
In fact, second through eighth are all on the same straightaway. Mark Martin now is trying to pass Dale Earnhardt.
You can see Mark working on Dale back there. That's a good shot of it.
Earnhardt is really carrying his car down in the corner hard, and we can see Mark get alongside and passes Earnhardt.
Did that with relative ease. And Ricky Rudd finally gets by Jeff Bodine also, and here comes Brett Bodine to pass him also.
And Morgan the gate Shepherd. Might be open.
Yep, the gate is open. Morgan Shepherd goes by as well. And Blake Speed's going to come up there, but Jeff Bodine gets back in line there, so he's back on the low side of the track again.
Oh, and Lake Speed and Jeff Bodine makes some contact. The six is going on the inside now. They've got Darrell Walter with a slow car up in front. Earnhardt gets by Jeff Bodine. So Jeff Bodine has lost, what, 5 or 6 spots in the last 2 laps?
Went from 2nd to 8th in the last 5 laps.
And I'm not so sure that it's just a matter of him getting up in the high groove. I think the car maybe not up to full call.
Sometimes you get a set of tires on there that simply don't work as well as the ones you had on before. You made a great pit stop, got him out in 2nd place. And look here, Mark Martin going around the 28 car of Lake Speed.
He's got 5th place, and Dale Earnhardt has 6th. Lake's back to 7th.
All these guys seem to be fading just a little bit as Mark Martin continues on the front end. Dale Earnhardt's car now running well.
I'm sure that the Richard Childress crew have continued to make adjustments on that car as they've made pit stops, and he is running good. Right now, Mark Martin's about 4.5 seconds behind Rusty Wallace. Martin in 2.
On top of Jeff O'Dine's car, looking forward at Lake Speed. Dale Earnhardt and Mark Martin as they go around Rick Wilson.
Jimmy Hensley has run a very good race this afternoon or this evening and is in 9th position right now.
He's coming up on Jeff Bodine. His car is really not going as well as it did earlier. Ooh, tries to get a nose under coming off the turn, but didn't quite work. And Brett Bodine is really working on Ricky Rudd up there for 2nd place. Brett Bodine having one of his best runs this year,
yes,
in the Quaker
sure
State
is.
Ford. That car has been fast in a lot of races, but they've had all kind of problems, and so it's good to see Brett running up there that good this late in the race. Maybe even having a shot at winning.
Well, Ricky Rudd has spent about the last 300 laps trying to contend with Jeff. He has disposed of him, and now he looks back in his rearview mirror and says, oh my gosh, there's the other person. There's Jeff and Jimmy.
They're 8th and 9th. Jeff Bodine turned 8th, Jimmy Hensley was 9th. Hensley wants that spot, he just can't muster enough strength to get alongside.
We understand that Kyle Petty is about to come back in the race after being out for a long, long time. 145 laps, as a matter of fact.
Yep, there he drives down on the apron, 3 and 4. And there's our leader, Rusty Wallace.
There's Kyle Petty, who's made it back onto the racetrack. The mellow yellow Pontiac was involved in a crash here on the main straightaway. It quite a while ago, but now he's back. Doesn't appear to be running very well. And there is Dale Jarrett, who comes back up the racetrack and tries to pick up as many Winston Cup points as he possibly can. That car, we understand, has had transmission problems.
Had trouble on the backstretch. Ricky Rudd has crashed.
The second place car, Ricky Rudd, has crashed, and he has heavy front end damage.
And the caution flag is out.
Had this car moving, but
left front tire's flat. We see dragging the racetrack and smoke coming out of the right front. Heavy damage to that car.
Let's find out what happened as we go to the replay.
Comes off the second corner and just absolutely loses control as he comes off the corner.
We have seen that so much tonight. Just no help, but coming off the second corner, the cars get loose.
Ernie Irvin did that. Now we've seen Ricky Rudd. Dick Trickle did it. So, yes. And Rudd trying to get his car behind pit wall and off pit road because he has a lot of work.
It is a matter of survival. No question about that. Here at Bristol, you got to survive. Ricky Rudd has not. Rusty Wallace is on pit road for another pit stop. Jerry's there.
And right in front of Rusty's pit, there's a trail of water on where Ricky Rudd brought his car behind the wall. On our crew cam now, watching them change tires. Now left side tires going on the number genuine draft Pontiac. Rusty Wallace, our leader. Left side tires leading the windshield. Car is down and away. And Dale Earnhardt is into the back pit. Here's John.
Richard Childers, Andy Petrie, and the crew have made major chassis adjustments. All right, it looks like this time they've got the car right. It will be just a four-tire change. Brakes already on. Left side's going on. Earnhardt throws his drink cup out as Rusty Wallace heads down the back stretch. Here comes Mark out, a quick pit stop for them. Earnhardt is down pit road, and also Lake Speed is just now pulling out.
And Jerry Punch is with Ricky Rudd.
Heavy damage on the front of the tie. Chevrolet, Ricky's still sitting in the car. Ricky, what happened over there?
I'm not really sure what you're saying, Jared, but I'm sure it's a reference to how I got tore up. I was working a high groove, and I don't know if I hung a tire in some debris or what. I don't know if I swelled. All I know is I lost it, and it was by myself, but it felt like I hung a tire into some dirt, rubber or something.
How bad is the car hurt, Ricky? What's the extent of the damage?
I'd say the car's hurt pretty bad. You know, they kept working with tires, trying to get me loosening up. The car pushed the whole time. Finally, they got me loose enough. It was a little too loose.
Take a look at the front of the car. What's left of the tie? Chevrolet pushed in pretty significantly. Gary Dehart and the crew are taking, basically trying to cut some of the sheet metal away here in the right front. And one of our Kevlar noses you saw earlier in our track back has been shortened considerably. That's Eddie Dickerson, who is the fabricator, works in the R&D department, along with Gary Dehart, the crew chief, working on the right front fender. We're under caution once again for heavy impact by Ricky Rudd here at Bristol International Raceway.
And a tough break for Ricky Rudd, who just may have got up, as he said, in that build-up rubber there at the high side. I don't know. Anyway, he lost it, and he spun and hit the inside retaining wall, and it's eliminated him from a win here at Bristol, Tennessee. We'll be right back. Formula One tomorrow morning. Right now, we've got the last 150 laps of the Bud 500, the top five. Wallace, Martin, Bodine, Shepherd, and Earnhardt. We're in the mountains here of northeastern Tennessee. Paul Page is in the mountains of Vancouver for a look at tomorrow's race.
Well, Bob, here in Vancouver, the Indy cars have qualified for tomorrow's Molson Indy Vancouver. And it was a spectacular final qualifying session with Scott Goodyear taking the pole in the last few minutes of qualifying in a lap that he described as hanging it all out. Starting alongside, it will be Bobby Rahal with the points leader, Nigel Mansell, alongside Paul Tracy in the second row. We'll have full coverage tomorrow here on ESPN. Now let's send you back to Bristol as the Winston Cup cars battle and Bob Jenkins.
Thank you, Paul, and a couple of guys who have not had particularly good seasons in IndyCar racing, Scott Goodyear and Bobby Rahal, will be in the front row for tomorrow's race that you can see live here on ESPN. Bobby Labonte has gotten out of the 22 car. Terry Labonte is in the machine now. Jerry's with Bobby.
And Steve Mill, one of the crew chiefs, coming over to check on Bobby. And Bobby, you climbed out of the car. A tough break for you. I understand you weren't feeling very well.
Yeah, maybe got a busted head or... knocked a crush panel out earlier in the door. Got a lot of fumes in it right now. I just fun out over there. I just kind of lost it for a minute. I tell you, it's a shame, but I guess the best thing to do is to get out and let somebody drive it. It's going to finish without tearing up, because I would have tore it up. Max Ross Ford was running all right. It just aggravated it myself because it happened, but oh well.
He's able to smile. We'll let him get over and get some fluids in him, get a little oxygen here. He's awake and alert, but we'll get him cleaned out here. Some of that carbon monoxide inside the car. He was showing pretty well, guys. He was only a couple laps down in the top 15.
Yeah, the car is now 16th, as a matter of fact. Jeff Gordon is running 21st, and there is a look at the rookie point standings going into this event, with Jeff on top with 233, Bobby second, Kenny Wallace third, and P.J. Jones has scored 62 points in the contest for Rookie of the Year. Pit stop summary: Rusty Wallace in first, out first. Brett Bodine second to third, Shepard third to fourth. Mark Martin, look at this, from fourth to now second. And Earnhardt stays in fifth, so we now have, again, a renewal of the Rusty Wallace and Mark Martin battle that we saw earlier tonight. Pace car comes in. The crowd rises to its feet. We are back to green. Wallace, Martin, and Brett Bodine, the first three.
10 cars in the lead lap.
History of weakness, though. Rusty Wallace will drive away for about 10 or 15 laps. Mark Martin will start gaining. We'll see. Looking inside Morgan from the top of Morgan Shepherd, Citgo Ford, and Dick Trickle in the Dirt Devil Pontiac.
Trickle is one lap down in 11th position.
Kyle Petty slowly going around on the inside of the race, right?
Brett Bodine, there he is in third, as Dick Trickle and Bill Elliott battle side by side. Here comes Morgan Shepherd and Dale Earnhardt back, Bill.
Right now, Dale Earnhardt, fifth place, Jim Goodrich Chevrolet. Bill, Ned, I would think that a top five finish for Dale Earnhardt would be a moral victory. After qualifying 19th and having to put on the back stretch?
Yeah, I would think so. And
obviously, he wants to win the race.
Sure.
But there we can see he drifted up just a little bit.
And John Gurdon, what do you think?
Well, guys, I think that they are happy to be where they are right now by virtue of pinning here on the back stretch. Their main problem tonight has been because of pinning on the back stretch, they get back. They have to deal with the lap cars, the cars on the inside of the line on the restart. Once they get out and get away from that, the times are very similar to what Rusty Wallace, the leader, has been running. Now, we told you that they had a bad push in the car early. Right now, they seem to have gotten that problem adjusted, and these guys hope to finish well. I think they want to win it. I don't think they're here just to finish fifth.
Well, he has won 7 times at this racetrack, this particular event 3 times, and Dale Earnhardt has not led a Winston Cup race since Watkins Glen. And his first ever win in NASCAR Winston Cup competition was at this facility in April of 1979.
Was that what NWC stands for?
NASCAR Winston Cup.
Gained on Morgan Shepherd, looks like a little bit.
And I tell you up front, Mark Martin is gaining on Rusty Wallace. And he's picking up in the front.
About what? 2 car lengths, maybe less than that, as Mark closes in on Rusty.
Kyle Petty has finally taken his mellow yellow Pontiac to the truck. I think he's going to put it up for tonight.
Rusty comes down and leads the 286th lap of the evening. Napa Field summary will show you where everyone's running.
Now, Rusty hasn't seen this in a long, long time. Hasn't looked up in the mirror and seen some car gaining on him. Because Mark Martin has been back in the back of the field, laps down and back of the field. Now, all of a sudden, this is the race for the lead.
Rusty's turning laps in excess of 207 miles an hour. The average speed of the race is 85.
207.
Did I say 207?
Yeah. 107.
107.
Yeah,
It is the world's fastest half mile, but it isn't that fast.
It's not that fast. That's right.
Well, it's 10 o'clock Eastern time, and for those of you just joining us, we have 132 laps to go in this Bud 500 that is currently being led by the number two car of Rusty Wallace. And there is Mark Martin, the Valvoline Ford car number six, running second. Third is Brett Bodine. Then fourth, Morgan Shepherd and Dale Earnhardt.
A lap ago, Rusty Wallace called Jimmy Means over in turn two, was able to get by him fairly easily. Mark Martin got hung on the outside coming off the corner. We can see he lost five or six car lengths to Rusty. Now, it looks like Earnhardt has caught. Yes, he has caught Morgan Shepherd. So this battle heats up.
And both of them may be catching Brett Bodine, who is having his best run of the year. Brett is currently third, and his best finish of this year, a fifth at the second Pocono race. But it is still Rusty Wallace, and so far he has been able to control things. No one has been able to take the lead away from him in the last many, many laps. Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, John Kernan, and Jerry Punch. Mark Martin is 3/4 of a second behind the leader, Rusty Wallace, with Brett Bodine almost 4 seconds behind. Morgan Shepherd is fourth, 4 seconds back, and Earnhardt is 4.33 seconds back. And here is Jerry Punch with a report.
Big question mark right now is, could Rusty Wallace make it all the way on fuel with 120 laps to go? Well, this is their computer here in the Miller Genuine Draft Pits. Let me show you. By calculations, according to what he's been getting on gas mileage, the maximum lap he could go would be 499.4. He would run out of gas a half a lap after taking the white flag. That's how close it would be. And he will need at least one more stop or a lot of luck to make it all the way. Let's check in over there in the back pit with John Kernan.
Jerry, we talked about how the Richard Childress crew has worked and worked and worked to get that car right. Just talked to Andy Petrie. He says, no problem. They can go the way. They can go the distance by about a lap, 2 laps. But just in case the car sputters, they've got a single gas can filled with Unocal gasoline waiting here in the pits in case Cotton Myers has to go across the wall and give it a little boost.
Well, this brings up another interesting aspect as we click off the last 115 or so laps of this race. Now a fuel concern begins to pop up.
Normally not a problem on a short track. We very seldom talk about it.
Lake Speed is backing up a little bit. He's been up front all day long. Now he's back with Harry Gant, Rick Mast. It looks like Harry's trying to get by him and takes a look on the inside. John, what's wrong with the 28 car?
Well, the car has gotten very, very loose on Lake Speed over the last two laps. He's had to back it off. Of course, they may have to make another pit stop. We get a caution. They'll come in, try and tighten that thing back up. But right now, the 28 car is very, very loose.
Well, the 33 car was very, very loose coming off the second corner of the last lap.
Yeah, Harry Gant almost lost it. But being the great driver he is, he got it back under control.
There you can see that we're well under the race record, but that's because back in 1971, Charlie Glotzbach, Charging Charlie, ran this race without a caution and averaged 101 miles an hour. Earnhardt and Morgan Shepherd are tooth and nail.
And that's almost hard to believe that this race could go 500 laps without a caution flag.
That's true.
What about Mark Martin? Now, we talked about Earnhardt and Rusty. Jerry, what's the answer to that question?
After some quick calculations, Steve Mills says that Mark Martin, Valvoline Ford, should be able to make it all the way. No concern on fuel there, so they're hoping maybe Rusty's calculations are correct, and he will run out of gas a half a lap from the checkered flag.
Now, of course, all this is dependent upon the fact that we must go green the rest of the way. There is
Harry Gant just went by Lake Speed, took that spot away. Now we see Rick Mast coming up. All these cars racing for position. Harry's now eighth.
Yeah.
Lake's in ninth, and the one car, Rick Mast, is in tenth.
Michael Waltrip in the 30 car. Here's the replay of how Gant got by Lake.
Goes in, just touches him in the back bumper a little bit.
And away he goes, and Michael Walters went by Rick Mast. And now Michael Walters is on the inside of the 28 car as they go by Jimmy Spencer down in turn one.
Michael Walker, haven't said a whole lot about him tonight. He's in the 11th position.
Running a good race.
Yeah. One lap down.
Yeah.
Michael hasn't had a good year. It's good to see him in there running good.
And once again, he gets jammed in behind the slow car. This time it was Jimmy Mean, the Napa Auto Parts store.
Now, Harry Gant has just totally driven away from late speed after he got around.
We understand that a couple of drivers have radioed their crews suggesting that they be relieved. One of them is Jeff Gordon, the other is Dick Trickle. So it is a tough, hot night out there on the half-mile Bristol Banks.
Dick Trickle is right in front of the leader right now, about to go two laps down. Remember, he stayed up there for a long time.
And John Kernan has more on the possible relief drivers.
Well, Bob, Dick Trickle has indeed said he's just worn out in the race car. He is asked to Skinny Wallace, whom he relieved under that first caution period because of the broken tip of his right scapula. Skinny has put his driver's suit back on. He's standing by down in his pit, waiting to see if Trickle will indeed pull in and ask for relief.
That'll be interesting if we see Kenny Wallace go back in the car, because he got out as early as possible due to his shoulder injury, but now he may get back in the car.
And right now, Dick Trickle is trying to stay in the lead lap in that Dirt Devil Pontiac.
He's one lap down. He's trying to keep from going two laps down.
Exactly. And meanwhile, Rusty Wallace has a bumper full on Martin right behind him.
Rusty had moved out about six or eight car lengths in front of Mark until he caught up to Trickle and hasn't been able to do much with him, and Mark has caught back up to him.
Now Jimmy Means is up there ahead of Trickle, and it becomes even more congested in turn three. And again, we said that Jeff Gordon might be asking for relief. Is that what your sources say, Jerry?
Exactly. Jeff Gordon does not have a carbon monoxide problem. What he's got is basically he's sick on his stomach from an intestinal flu. I went over and talked to Ray Everhand just a minute ago, and Ray said, we can't find anyone to put in the race car. He said, as a matter of fact, he looked at me and said, you've got a fire suit on. What size helmet do you wear? No, not me. Not me. But a big pass forward on the racetrack with Harry Gant and Jimmy Hensley.
Yeah, Gant passes Hensley, and Gant goes to seventh.
The Rusty Wallace finally gets around the Dick Trickle car.
Now Mark Martin.
Oh, and here's trouble. Rick Wilson spins into the wall here on the front straightaway.
The yellow comes out, and so this fuel situation becomes a moot point. He crashes at almost exactly the same spot that Kyle Petty did early in the race, at the end of the pit road.
And I'll tell you what, I believe Dick Griffin was sharp enough to get his lap back from Rusty Wallace.
Rick Wilson drives the car in through the infield to the back
stretch. Look at the oil streak that he
leaves. Oh, yeah.
Look at the oil behind that car. So he has broken an oil fitting, an oil line or something. That dark line following that car is oil.
It's a good spot from the Blockbuster video blimp. And here comes Rusty and Mark. Jerry Punch is right there.
Be the last pit stop of the day, barring any of the caution flags. Let's see what the race on pit road does. As Pontiac crew getting surface, two on the top, six on the bottom. Pontiac on top, Ford on bottom. Wallace and Martin, as you watch the top two cars getting service. Left side now on Rusty Wallace. They're still working on the right side of the Valvoline Ford. Left side tires already on. Wallace, he is down the way. Now left side of the Valvoline Ford is just getting up on the jack. Left side lug just going on. Rusty Wallace has already pulled to turn one. Here is Brent Bodine, then Mark Martin, and then Morgan Shepherd and Jeff Bodine as they head back to turn one.
Like they may have had a little bit of a problem on the right rear of Mark Martin's car, but anyway, Brett Bodine did beat him out, and so it's going to be Wallace, Brett Bodine, and Mark Martin, Morgan Shepherd, and Jeff Bodine for the restart.
Both Bill Elliott, you mentioned Dick Trickle getting a lap back, both he and Bill Elliott.
And here's the spin by, I guess we should be able to see, he comes along and Jimmy Spencer was right behind him. Now whether or not there was any contact or not, I don't know. Couldn't tell from our speed shot as Rick Wilson went around.
Anyway, Rick is out of the race. He's parked the STP Pontiac between turns 1 and 2 in the infield. We have got 95 laps to go here at Bristol. 407 to 500 laps. Rusty Wallace, Brett Bodine, Mark Martin, Morgan Shepherd, and Jeff Bodine. Then Dale Earnhardt, Jimmy Hensley, Lake Speed, Rick Mast, and Harry Gant. 11 through 15, Michael Waltrip, Dick Trickle, Bill Elliott, Bobby Hillen, and Phil Parsons. 16 through 20, Terry Labonte in relief for his brother, Dave Marcus, Jimmy Means, Greg Sachs, and Jeff Gordon is now in 20th position. We're going to take another break during this caution period and be back with more from Bristol. One lap has been completed under green. Rusty Wallace has the lead. Here comes Brett Bodine in the green 26 Quaker State Ford. Second, third is Mark Martin, but there are two cars between Brett and Mark. They are Bill Elliott and Phil Parsons.
And Brett Bodine got caught up on the outside of Bill Elliott, which allowed Rusty Wallace to pull away.
Dale Earnhardt is passing on the outside.
The lap cars were allowed to start down on the inside on the restart. They were actually holding up those on the outside, but that's just simply the way it is. It wasn't that they were intentionally holding them up.
That would be Michael Waltrip got a little bit high, and Jeff Bodine was able to get by. Now Jimmy Hensley gets alongside, and Michael has opened the gate. Now they're all trying to go by. Here's Lake Speed trying to get on the inside of him.
And Michael moves up, gives it the room.
Ooh,
they get awfully close.
Rick Mast is right behind Lake Speed. And so is Harry Gant.
Speed just before this last caution flag.
There's still 10 cars on the main lap.
Well, Rusty Wallace really got a great way this traffic shook down on this last caution flag. Bill Elliott on the inside hung up Jeff Bodine, Brett Bodine, and Mark Martin just long enough that he's able to get about a straightaway lead on those guys.
Napa Field summary. Cars on the lead lap.
You see Sterling Marlin back 125 laps down in 26. That looks strange.
Yeah.
171 laps down.
Darrell Walter is 250 laps
down. And we can see just Rusty Wallace is.
He has everything to himself right now. However, Mark Martin has just passed Brett Bodine for second, and now Mark sets his sights on Rusty, about a half a straightaway ahead.
It is 2,500 seconds.
It's substantial. I would guess that Mark Martin, Steve Meehl, and that crew, hadn't that right rear tire loosened up? If you just joined us, Mark Martin had a right rear tire loosened up early on in the going. He made an unscheduled stop, lost two laps. And I would think that it messed the threads up enough on those studs that that's one reason their pit stops have been a little bit slower than normal. They have to be awfully careful not to cross-thread some of those lug nuts.
Wallace is the leader. Brett Bodine back in third place. This is his best race of the year so far. Now we're on top of Morgan Shepherd, 6:04.
And he has caught Brett Bodine really working on him for that position. Not too far behind him is Dale Earnhardt.
They're up in their Blockbuster video blimp.
What is it?
Blockbuster, isn't it?
Good. I've been expecting you to say Blockbuster all evening. And I've been expecting to say it all evening, too.
The power of suggestion.
That's right.
Don't ask me to say it again. Dick Trickle had an opportunity to get a relief driver, but I don't think he did take that opportunity to put somebody else in the car, did he?
I guess they put some cold water on him, and he's feeling okay, and there's Jeff Gordon, who had also indicated that he wasn't feeling well, but they then hit that car with a brake dump, and he's feeling better.
Fresh air can make a big difference in how you feel.
And never seen Morgan closed up right on the back bumper as Brett Bonine caught Dave Marcuson. Look at Earnhardt. Wow, goes to the corner right behind those two. This is a race for third, fourth, and fifth. Brett goes up the hill a little bit. Morgan tried to get alongside. Couldn't quite make it.
Mark Martin has closed the gap just a little bit as we watch this three-car battle. A little bit on Rusty Wallace. He's down to about 2 seconds now.
Now Morgan's got Brett, and so does Dale.
Yep, they opened up the gate, and away they went.
Four laps to go.
Earnhardt trying to get by Morgan Shepherd.
Morgan Shepherd has been just quietly excellent this year. He's fifth in points and very, very consistent.
Ooh, Earnhardt
taking a look again.
Earnhardt takes a look, and everybody that stand up
and gasping also.
Man, as he closed up on Morgan going in those corners.
It's a real runoff.
Watch as he goes down the corner. Watch how he closes up right on the back bumper. Oh, and Blake Speed spins up in turn one.
And another caution wave. Blake Speed had a good run going. He was eighth on the lead lap. But he tastes the concrete in turn number two. And now the Haviland Ford is crippled and moving down the backstretch. Here it is.
This is coming off turn four. Rick Mass trying to get on the inside. And I would guess they're going to make some contact. Yep, just a little bit.
Not much, but it didn't take much.
And here again. Thought he was going to go on the outside and wisely decided to go on the inside. Pit stops again.
Yep. Rusty is in. So is Mark Martin, Jerry.
And we'll stack them three deep once again. The 2-6 and 21. Pontiac and a pair of Fords. Rusty Wallace at the top of your screen. Left side tires going on there. And the car number 21, the Citgo Ford, getting left side tires also. Rusty Wallace off the jack. He is down and away. They are meanwhile working down the left side of the Valvoline Ford of Mark Martin. He is off the jack and away. And here comes the car number 21. That is Morgan Shepherd following Jeff Bodine down pit road. And behind Shepherd is Brett Bodine as they hit for turn one.
So Rusty and Mark go in first and second, and they come out first and second. 69 laps remain in this race. We've completed 431.
If you like movies.
Welcome back to Bristol International Raceway in Tennessee for ESPN Speed World's live coverage of the NASCAR Winston Cup Bud 500. Well, the Arlington Million will be run at 6 o'clock tomorrow evening here on ESPN. And Dear Doctor won the race last year, is racing again this year. So Dear Doctor is trying to be the first repeat winner. Will he do it? Join us at 6 o'clock tomorrow evening for the Arlington Million from Chicago.
Ricky Rudd is back in. You see him down on the inside there with a lot of sheet metal off of his car. He's 85 laps down.
And a pit stop summary showing that Rusty and Mark went in first and out first. Martin second, second. Shepherd third to fourth. Earnhardt fourth to fifth. And Brett Bodine from fifth to sixth. Third place now will belong to Jeff Bodine. Morgan Shepherd fourth and Dale Earnhardt fifth. We get stacked up for a restart. Once again, it's a very slow restart that Rusty Wallace leads them to bring it out.
This time, Mark Martin did not get hung up on the outside of the left car.
Jeff Bodine trying to run those two down.
He's now led 357 laps as we watch from Jeff Rukin.
There's a checkered flag. There's the wind right up in front. Ooh, I saw 8,400, 129 miles an hour. These cars clearly much faster with those fresh tires on.
That's
and no traffic.
That's a good difference.
Maybe up to 130 that time.
Boy, it doesn't take them long to go off of one turn into the next. Not much straightaway here.
Yeah, just look how little straightaway, how little of a chance these drivers have to relax. Now, you're relaxing. Now, you're turning. That's how long they have down each straightaway for any type of relaxation at all.
Maybe 3 seconds, more like two. Rusty maintains the interval about 4 or 5 car lengths over Mark Martin. Rusty has won 5 times this year. His most recent victory was at New Hampshire. Mark Martin, on the other hand, has won the last 2 consecutive NASCAR Winston Cup races and is looking for 3 in a row. Now, there is Todd Bodine. Jerry, what's he doing with the helmet?
We've already established that Jeff Gordon is ill in the car number 24. Now, Rick Hendrick, the car owner, has appealed to NASCAR. They couldn't really find anyone else to go in the car. And you're not supposed to allow a rookie to relief drive. It's just Todd Bodine didn't qualify for this race and hasn't driven another car. NASCAR said, okay, we'll let him go in the race car if you need to. And Todd Bodine is standing by to relief drive for Jeff Gordon. Now, Jeff right now is in 20th spot, has quite a few laps for 21st place car, Wally Dolan back. So if we get another caution flag, expect to see the driver change here in the 24 pit.
And we see Morgan Shepherd.
By Jeff, and here comes Dale right with him.
Well, when you open the gate, you just drive right on by.
Earnhardt hopes there's not another caution because he loses every time on the pit stops with him pitting on the back straight.
Yep.
So he said, just let this thing go. Let's go add a more caution so we won't have to pit him for it. They're coming up on late speed. Late speed is 2 laps down now, being shown in the 12th position.
He moved over and let the others pass by to the outside.
See just how much Earnhardt closes up on the back of Morgan Shepherd. Once he drives up.
Oh yeah, when he's going into the corner, he just drives right up on his back bumper. But Morgan stretches it a little bit down the straightaway.
Look at that.
I don't think this crowd has sat down, have they?
No, not much. They pay for seat and stand up all the time. And we can see these two cars are just driven away from Jeff Bodine
and Brett.
Bodine running the races for the 5th position.
And there we see how far the mark that Earnhardt has to go to catch the leader, Rusty Wallace.
He's led 371 laps so far of the 448 that we have completed.
And Rusty is just driving away from Mark Martin.
Here he is.
There's Darrell Waltrip, who was involved in an earlier accident. Darrell has won 12 races at this track, and not tonight.
Kenny Schrader was involved in that same crash that Darrell Waltrip was involved in.
He's won this particular race 7 times, Darrell Waltrip has.
He runs one more lap. He will pass Dale Jarrett, and that'll be 3 points. You never know what that might mean.
That's right.
We'll see.
It could be the difference between one position. There's the Bodine brothers, along with Jimmy Hensley, Jeff, Brett, and Jimmy.
I wonder what Hensley will do when he comes up on his boss man. Jeff Bodine owns that car he's driving.
Yeah.
You'll probably pass him if you can.
Exactly.
Jeff will probably beat it. But he'll make it work for him. But he's got Brett to contend with third.
Yeah.
He's working on him. Jimmy Hensley is really working on Brett Bodine there right now.
Brett, this is the best race on the racetrack right now. Rusty Wallace is just driving away from Martin Martin right now.
And Morgan Shepherd has moved about 2 car lengths ahead of Dale Earnhardt, so.
So at the end of 454 laps, the top 5 here in the Busch 500 NASCAR Winston Cup race. Rusty Wallace, followed by Mark Martin, Morgan Shepherd, Dale Earnhardt, and Jeff Bodine. Stay with us. We'll be back in a moment. laps to go. Rusty Wallace leads Mark Martin, Morgan Sheppard, Dale Earnhardt, Jeff Bodine, Brett Bodine, Jimmy Hensley, Harry Gant, Rick Mast, and Dick Trickle. There's the beautiful Blockbuster video blimp that has provided some excellent overhead shots of the action here tonight. And there is the battle up front. Now, Mark Martin has really closed in on Rusty Wallace. And as we pan back a little bit, there's Morgan Sheppard and Dale Earnhardt for third and fourth.
And we can see Morgan has pulled a couple. And look here at this race.
Brett Bodine, something must have happened to his car.
Yep.
All of a sudden, he had moved up to fourth, had passed his brother, Jeff. But something happened to the 26 car. Now it looks like it's getting back up to speed.
He's got some damage on the left rear, no doubt about that.
Someone has driven up in the back of that car, there's no doubt. Let's see what happens. Harry Gant's right behind him. They come off the corner.
Boom.
Well, Harry hits him. That's where that damage came from.
Yeah.
But he couldn't help it because Brett has just slowed down.
It's like his foot slipped off the accelerator or something. Well,
he's back up to speed now. But he dropped back to ninth place.
Yeah, he lost several on track positions.
He was in fourth. He was in fourth. Or I beg your pardon, he was in fifth.
And meanwhile, Jeff Bodine was in front of all this group. He has fallen back. It's Harry Gant, Rick Mast, Jimmy Hensley. Then Jeff Bodine and Brett Bodine. There you see Jeff Bodine. Jeff right now is in eighth spot. And there's the seventh place car of Jimmy Hensley. Sixth is Rick Mast. And fifth is Harry Gant.
Jerry Punch, what in the world happened to Brett Bodine?
Brett just radioed and told Donnie Richardson his crew chief that the car just shut off on the racetrack. That suddenly the motor just quit. That's why Harry drove up in the back of the car. It's sputtering and missing off and on in the turn. So problems here in the late lap for the Quaker State team.
Had a little bit of damage and bodywork ragged on the racetrack. Now Trickle goes to the high side of Jeff Bodine. And passes him.
Sure does. Bill Elliott is for position. You see Dick Trickle on the left side of her screen, the black 40, the red 11 is Bill Elliott, and that is for position.
There's Rick Mast going around the 28 car of late speed. Mast having a good run. He's only had two top 10 so far this year, so he's having a good run at the Stoll Classic 40.
And guys, I'm telling you, we got ourselves a race.
Yeah, we do. Here's Mark Martin making a bid for the lead. Couldn't pull it off. Boy, the crowd went crazy.
They got a lot of traffic right in front of them and very few laps to go. So Mark Martin went the 8 laps to get it done.
And we've said after Rusty's car runs a while on new tires, it seems to give away a little bit. Martin seems to be getting stronger. Boy, you're right. They're coming up on some heavy traffic. Look at it.
Dave Marcus, Lake Speed, Phil Parsons, Ricky Rudd, Terry Labonte in relief of his brother Bobby, also up ahead of the leader.
Jeff Gordon has pulled into the pits. Apparently, that driver changed.
Todd Bodine replacing Jeff Gordon in a relief role, the Napa Field summary. And there is Jeff being lifted out of the race car, and Todd Bodine, the winner of last night's Busch Grand National race here at Bristol, climbing in.
And Morgan Sheppard is off the pace, going down the back straightaway. We see him very slow. He went in turn one, and the car just went straight ahead. And looks like he's trying to get back. No, he's not back up to speed.
There's Wally Dahlenbach passing him.
And going in three, Phil Parsons on the outside. Mark looked on the inside, but couldn't make the pass.
Well, I
thought Mark maybe had him.
He's working on it.
Looks like these cars are awfully equal, Ned.
Yeah, there's not much there. Mark might be a little bit faster right now. I think he is.
But as you guys have said many times, there is a big difference between catching somebody and passing them, especially here. Mm-hmm. 21 laps to do it. Mark Martin does.
Morgan Shepherd has dropped back. He continues to drop back. They'll move Morgan back to the 8th position.
There's a look from overhead.
Looks like he's going to try to get under him.
In fact, Morgan Shepherd about to go a lap down right now. He's going to turn one. There he is down on the inside. So now there will be 8 cars in the lead lap.
Last car on the lead lap is Jeff Bodine. And the Western Auto Mechanic of the race is Steve Meehl from Mark Martin's crew. Congratulations to him.
Oh, and we saw Mark Martin wiggle, wiggle.
Jerry, what's happened to Morgan Shepherd?
Word from Eddie Wood is that Morgan Shepherd, since go forward, has broken an axle, so he has no choice but to slow it down and just try to ride out and finish a tough break for a driver who stayed in the lead lap here all evening long.
And it is a tough break, and it will undoubtedly cost him some points also. Morgan, fifth, and the standings going in. So the average speed of the race now is 87 miles an hour compared to the record of 101. We'll be right back. With 12 laps to go, we have a new leader. Mark Martin was able to pass Rusty Wallace, and Mark Martin is trying for 3 wins in a row, and he's just about to lap Jeff Bodine, who is running in 8th spot.
And Jeff Bodine does not want to be lapped. This could play into Rusty Wallace's hands. Here's a replay of Mark Martin as he comes off turn 2. Gets alongside Rusty. Goes in turn 3. And they race through the corner side by side.
10 laps to go. Make that 9 laps to go. 491 complete. And now Mark Martin appears to be well in control of this race as Rusty, 2-3 car lengths behind.
But he's close enough. He's close enough. And there's slow cars up there. There's Kenny Schrader, Brett Bodine, Jeff Bodine still. Mark Martin can't get by him.
Don't go away, folks. We have seen excitement so far, and it's not over yet. Rusty now sneaks it right up on the back bumper of Mark as he tries to make his way through traffic. He still has not passed Jeff Bodine up ahead. Ken Schrader moves over.
Mark is saying, fella Ford driver, give me a break. I need to go.
6 laps to go when they come down.
And now he's going to run across
Brad Bodine.
Brad Bodine, and I think that he and Jeff racing.
Yes, oh, they are. Yeah. Absolutely.
They're racing for position, so obviously they don't want to back up.
They're not going to give any.
5 to go.
The Rusty car, I think he's just lost the handle on it because he's not able, even though Mark might be held up a little bit there right now, he's still pulling away a little bit from Rusty.
Right. Four laps to go. There's Steve Meehl.
And now there's a lot of traffic right in front of these cars. What's going to happen? Wally Diamondback, Dick Trickle, Bill Elliott. What in the world is going to happen now? As all these cars get jammed up in front of their leader.
But Rusty continues to hold back. And Steve Meehl apparently is talking to NASCAR about Jeff Bodine and Brett Bodine, but they don't want to give, obviously. We got 2 laps to go for Mark Martin. 2 to go.
Meanwhile, Bill Elliott and the 40 car, I think, are racing for position. Brett Bodine, Jeff Bodine, they're racing for position. But behind all this, these guys are racing position. The 6 and the 2, and that's for the win.
Here comes the white flag. 1 lap to go for Mark Martin. There it is.
Rusty on the outside.
Tries to go to the outside in turn 1, but Mark blocks the way. Now Rusty will look high off of turn 2. They've got a half a lap to go. Wallace tries to make a move to the inside. He's going to make it to the outside. No, he can't do it there. It's going to be Mark Martin winning the Bud 500 over Rusty Wallace.
Man, oh man.
3 in a row for Rusty, or rather for Mark Martin.
Did that get exciting?
And watch the 6 car. Watch the 6 car.
He might not have even seen the checkered flag.
I don't think he did. I don't think he saw the checkered flag. He is still racing.
He wants to talk to Jeff Bodine.
Well, he won the race, so...
He's a little hot.
Yeah, looks like he is. Anyway, he continues the win streak. It began at Watkins Glen. It continued at Michigan. And now here tonight. It's his first ever win on the high banks of Bristol in his 14th career start here. Wow, that was exciting. He only had led 66 laps. Rusty Wallace led many more. Here's John Kernan with Steve Meehl.
Steve, you and Jack hugging each other on that toolbox. I bet you thought after the problems you had early in this race, you probably couldn't win this race.
Well, we felt like we could win. We knew all day Rusty was going to be tough. I messed up on a first or second stop and didn't get the right rear tight enough, but Mark run the car real hard. We got some brakes in traffic. Kyle was going to be good, and he had trouble. At the end there, we didn't get a lot of help from our Ford teammates, but we held Rusty off, so we're pretty tickled with it.
What about the pass that he made, and then, I mean, the lap traffic, like you said, wouldn't get out of the way?
Well, they weren't really lap traffic. They wouldn't have lapped down yet, and they were racing for position, and, you know, I understand all that, but a little short, tight racetrack like this, it gets aggravating. We caught him three or four times, never could get back to him, but we felt like, you know, at the end, we had something for him.
Well, the important thing is for Mark Martin and his team is they were able to hold Rusty off, Bob.
Yep, that is the most important thing, and we will be back with the winner interview of Mark Martin here in just a few minutes when we come back from this break. Martin wins, Rusty Wallace second. At Bristol International Raceway.
And Victor Ladysburg.
It's a hot time in the old town tonight. The brakes on Mark Martin's winning car have flared up here. They're trying to douse it with water. In any case, looks like Mark is just about whipped.
What'd I tell you? That the winner's going to get out and sit down.
Well, here's the AC Delco winner circle in Jerry Punch.
Well, you saw how hot the car was. You can imagine how the man inside that car had to be for the last 3.5 hours. And Mark just climbed out. He's getting his breath here. We'll let him get a nice cold sip of Gatorade and get a big... deep breath. And Mark, congratulations on an outstanding effort. You came back from 2 laps down.
Valvoline, Ford, and Goodyear, great job tonight. I'm not going to be much on an interview. I'm out of breath.
He's obviously exhausted. Dale Earnhardt came by. He was having a lot of the drivers in this heat tonight. It's incredible they can go 500 laps here on a half-mile racetrack. We'll let him get his breath in just a moment, and he's looking up here and trying to get some fluid in him and getting his breath, giving his watch to Arlene there, his wife, as he wins it 3 in a row, and now he's able to stand up and have a little bit of strength. And okay, Mark, coming from 2 laps down, a near catastrophe, that right rear tire a little bit loose on one of the stops.
Yeah, I can't believe we won a race. I don't know if we had the best car or not. Kyle run awful good. Rusty was awesome. Rusty's pit crew is incredible. I tell you, I just thank the Lord that he's really in there with me tonight, I tell you, to make it up and get by Rusty. He was trying hard. He drove his heart out. Never seen anybody drive any harder than Rusty Wallace. He was trying.
You had a windshield full of Fords in those last couple laps with the 15 and the 26. You had to be a little bit concerned if you could hold Rusty off.
I wasn't too proud of Jeff Bodine. That cost me the race. I would have never done that to him, but at least we still won, so I guess there's no harm done.
Did you see the checkered flag come out, Mark? I know you said you ran almost another lap under full speed. I know you were probably concentrating so hard. Did you see the flag come down?
Yeah, I was running into Jeff. That's why I ran an extra lap. I was mad.
Mark Martin, Mr. August. We've had a Mr. March and a Mr. September a year ago and here again, and now we have a new Mr. August in Batesville, Arkansas's Mark Martin.
That is correct. He has won all the NASCAR Winston Cup races in the month of August, 1993. Mark Martin in Victory Lane here in Bristol, Tennessee. Buster Video Blimp has provided some excellent shots from overhead. We've enjoyed having them with us here today. It's based in Orlando, Florida. And we certainly do thank them for giving us the great aerial shots tonight. Well, coming up next here on ESPN, keep up with everything that's going on in the world of baseball with Baseball Tonight. That is coming up next. John Kernan is with Rusty Wallace.
Rusty sitting over here by the NASCAR trailer waiting to get just a little bit of oxygen. Rusty, an exhausting 500-lap race, and you and Mark put on quite a show there at the end.
Yeah, it was a good race. Mark ran awful good throughout the day. My car was great. The motor was good. The car handled perfect. It's just that my neck got a little tired on me a little at the end. I was going to put a little lighter steering box on. I chose not to, and it hurt me. But, you know, right there about 30 laps to go, it was starting to really bother me. And he started catching me. And 12 laps to go, it's so close, but so yet so far away. I thought I could hold it off. Couldn't do it.
He made quite a move on you, and then the lap traffic kind of held him up, and it looked like you were going to get another shot at him.
Yeah, I tried, but he did a good job mirror driving near me down the back straight, which I'd have done the same thing. But I'd like to congratulate him. Three in a row, that was like I did earlier in the year, and I know how that feels good to him, and I'm proud of him. And with the Miller Genuine Draft car, it ran strong, and like I said, handled good, and pit stops were great again. I never got beat out of pits all day long, not one time. And we're second in points, and so we're chipping away, but Earnhardt just keeps slugging away like a John Deere tractor, just keeps putting along out there.
He sure does, but Rusty's not doing too badly at the short tracks, Bob. Three wins, two second-place finishes in five races.
That's right. He still has not finished lower than second in the short track races that have been held in 1993. Crowd beginning to file out after a great race here, won by Mark Martin. 500 is over, and Mark Martin has come away with his third consecutive NASCAR Winston Cup victory, finishing fifth, his best finish of the year. Rick Mast, here's Jerry.
If there's a comeback driver in the month of August, it's Rick Mast. From that violent impact at Watkins Glen, Rick, to a great top five finisher tonight, congratulations.
Well, you know, we ran pretty good. The thing of it is, we've run good. So many races this year, each time we've run good, like Watkins Glen, when I about broke my neck, you know, we have trouble. We had a top five car at Michigan last week, we had trouble. We had a top five car at Pocono, we had trouble. You know, tonight we had a top five car, well, sort of, you know, but we didn't have trouble. I think the track changed, like, I don't know if it got cooler or what happened. About halfway through the race, my car got real tight. And each time we had a caution, we'd come in and we'd take a donut out, put one in, change the wedge, change the bite, you know, change the air pressure. That's why everybody beat us out of the pits each time. We was trying to get the car better. We got a little bit better, but at the end, the thing just wouldn't turn good in the center. But, you know, we're pleased with fifth. It's pretty good. It's, you know, it's not good as it want to be, but, you know, where luck's been, you know, fifth is good.
Indeed. The truth that the night skies don't always finish last. Sometimes they finish fifth, guys.
Good run by Rick Mast, and we will come back and wrap up the entire evening and give you the results and the current point standings when we return to Bristol International Raceway. Baseball tonight is coming up next. Let's take a look at the entire field rundown. Mark Martin won, Rusty Wallace was second, Dale Earnhardt third, then Harry Gant and Rick Mast.
And 6th through 10th, Jimmy Hensley, Brett Bodine, Jeff Bodine, all of those eight in the lead lap. Kenny Wallace winds up in 9th place, being the top rookie, and Michael Waltrip getting in the top 10.
11th through 15th, Bill Elliott, Bobby Hill, and Morgan Shepherd. Bobby Hill and Morgan Shepherd and Phil Parsons all in the same lap, and Bobby Labonte credited with a 15th place finish after Terry got in the car for him.
16 through 20, Lake Speed, Dave Marcus, Jimmy Means, Greg Sachs, and Jeff Gordon.
21st through 25th, Wally Dallenbach Jr., Ricky Rudd, Sterling Marlin, Ken Schrader, and Jimmy Spencer, all of those drivers having trouble, spending a lot of time behind the wall.
26 through 30, Ernie Irvin, another car had trouble, Derek Cope had trouble, Rick Wilson trouble, Darrell Walter trouble, and Kyle Petty. All these fellows had some kind of contact with wall or other cars.
And the final four, Dale Jarrett, Hut Strickland, Bobby Hamilton, and Terry Labonte, those involved in an accident. Now the top point standings, Dale Earnhardt continues to lead, Rusty Wallace moves up to second, Mark Martin third, Dale Jarrett drops from second to fourth, and Morgan Shepherd hangs in there in fifth position. 6th through 10th in the points, Kyle Petty, Ken Schrader, Jeff Bodine, Ernie Irvin, and Jeff Gordon is 10th. A lot of racing coming up tomorrow. Started off with the Grand Prix of Belgium at 7:50 Eastern Time with Bob Barsha and Eddie Cheever doing the commentary. The IndyCar race from Vancouver is at 4 o'clock Eastern Time tomorrow afternoon. Our next NASCAR Winston Cup race will be on Sunday, September 5th, this coming Sunday, a week from tomorrow. It all begins at 1 o'clock Eastern Time, the Southern 500, where Dale Earnhardt is the defending champion. My thanks to Ned Jarrett, Benny Parsons, John Kernan, and Dr. Jerry Punch. Thanks for joining us. Congratulations to Mark Martin. I'm Bob Jenkins. So long, everyone.